This is Fred Foy. Join us now as we travel back in time and relive some of the magic that was part of the golden age of radio. It's time now for another episode of The Glowing Dial.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends, the soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water, then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto, spelled sideways, is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Now the hosts of The Glowing Dial, Big John and Steve.
Well, thank you very much, Fred Foy, and hello, everybody. Welcome to another edition of The Glowing Dial, that most fantabulous old-time radio program you're ever going to want to hear anywhere. I'm Big John Matthews, your warm, rotund host, and sitting across the desk from me once again is my co-host, Stu Chisholm. Hey, buddy.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going.
Yeah.
We had some computer problems, last week, and we were going to have Greg be on a couple of shows, but like I say, we had some problems. We had to reload the whole computer, but now we're up and working and recording, and it's wonderful. We have a number of things we're celebrating here on this edition of The Glowing Dial. We're going to play games with you this time. We got four game shows for you. It's also the first day this show premieres, July 20th, is the anniversary of the moon landing. So I know Stu's got a little story about one of the moon missions. I think I'll have him tell. And also, it's your birthday, August 7th, sir.
That's right. I'll be 21 again.
21, not 39, like Jack Benny, maybe at least. So we wish you a happy birthday in advance on that.
Thank you. Where's my presents?
Yeah. We're going to get started with everything and more right after this.
Perhaps the funniest series ever on radio is now available in a 14-CD limited edition package. That's all 273 episodes, plus bonus material. Yes, available at last. The complete story of Chicken Man. This is the ultimate collector's package, mastered from the original master tapes by Dick Orkin, Chicken Man's creator and voice. Aside from every Chicken Man episode ever made, this package includes interviews with key players, behind-the-scenes stories, and an official color photo, personally autographed by Chicken Man himself. And each limited edition package is individually numbered. A very naughty criminal mastermind, now a reformed swell guy, says of our hero,
"The most fantastic crime fighter the world has ever known."
An anonymous admirer says,
"He's poultry in motion."
By now, you're probably asking yourself, how the heck can I get one of these neato packages? Well, simply hop online and go to glowingdial.com. Scroll down and you'll see the magnificent No Expense Spared advertisement and ordering link. Remember, this is a limited edition numbered package, so you better hurry up and order. If you don't, you might miss out. And then all I can say is, well...
And we are back, folks. It's time to get started with the program. Just before the break, we told you about a little story that Stu had. It has something to do with a laser.
Well, yeah, I was really into the whole NASA, you know, thing. It was going on all the time I was in school. My folks used to let me, you know, stay home from school to watch them on TV. They thought that was pretty much more educational than anything I was going to learn in school. They were pretty liberal, but I was a total science head, and they nurtured that. And I collected newspaper articles and you name it. So I was there. I forced myself to watch the whole moon landing thing. And then I got into lasers, too. Another nerdy thing that I did was built an Edmund Scientific helium neon gas laser. And one day, it was one of the Apollo missions. I forget exactly which number it was, but it was one of the later ones. It was either 14 or 15. It's the one that went to Hadley Rill. Mm-hmm. And there was one at the Terminator where they were supposedly on the dark side. But it wasn't, you know, it wasn't really dark. They were just as close as anyone had come, I guess. Anyway, I'm out on the front lawn, and I could hear the mission, you know, because by then they'd become routine, and everyone tuned out but me, I think. But they were still playing it on the television. I think it was on PBS or something. And I'm listening through the screen door. And I got this wild idea. I was out there with my big telescope. I had a small reflecting telescope that I used as a spotter scope because it wasn't nearly as powerful as the refracting telescope that I had.
Right.
And I also had my third, my photographer's tripod. I put my laser on it, and I had been, you know, shooting it around the neighborhood to see if there was a terrestrial object that I couldn't hit. And back then, you know, you weren't limited to 5 milliwatts. I had a 15-watt laser. You could feel it on your skin. You could feel it moving through your hair. It wasn't hot, but you could feel it. But, of course, it still wasn't powerful enough. It was in that frequency band. It was more pinkish than red now. So you might hit cloud bottoms if they were really low, but you couldn't hit, satellites or anything. And they're up on the moon, and I'm listening to them talk, and I'm thinking, gee, maybe I could hit the moon, because it was right overhead. I mean, it was, you know, it was an evening, and it was just plunk right over my head.
Yeah.
And, because I was looking at it, and so I got this idea that maybe I could shoot it parallel to the telescope, and of course that didn't work. And, then I thought, gee, it needs magnification. What if I shot it through the telescope? And then I thought, you know, that's not going to work either. I'd have to shoot it backwards through the telescope. So I gave it a try. And for the next, hour or so, as the moon's drifting, by the way, I'm trying to hastily attach this laser to the front of my telescope. And I managed to pull it off, and I used the little spotter scope, and I got the moon in just the right spot, and I turned the thing on, and I focused it really hard, and I saw just for the briefest little, moment, well, actually, it was a lot, it was maybe 30 seconds, I saw this little pink dot right on the terminator of the moon, and I'm jumping up and down, and I'm hearing from the inside, I'm hearing the astronauts back and forth. And then NASA said something, and I hear one of the astronauts, and I don't swear by it, but it might have been Pete Conrad. But anyway, and he said, looks like someone from Earth is trying to say hello. Just as I'm shining my laser right at the moon and freaking out because I hit it. And then NASA said something, and they answered to it, and they went on to business as usual. And the frustrating thing for me has been that you can find on YouTube, you can find the moonwalk for Apollo 11, you can find all kinds of clips from the various missions. I have not been able to find that anywhere. I haven't found a transcript. I haven't found a clip. So if any of our listeners happens to have access to some NASA archive or just the time to fiddle around and dig for it or something, I would love to find that clip because I can't help. I mean, I like to think they were talking about me. They could have been talking about something totally irrelevant or unrelated, but yeah, I like to think because it happened at that moment, they were talking about me.
Well, you know what? I just saw today, I was rooting around a website by name otrcat.com,
really?
And I mentioned him, John, over there, because he has let us use some of his synopsis information and some of our information that we pass on to you about the shows that we play. So I told him I'd give him an on-the-air shout. He's got a special going on right now Of course, that's at the time of recording this show. I'm not sure that it's going to be on when you hear the show, but he's still going to have the stuff. But a lot of the NASA mission tapes, and he's got them on MP3s, and he's got them through the, you know, the Mercury, the Friendship 7, I think. He's got the Apollo missions. So there's a good chance that what you're looking for might be in there somewhere, and I'll show you that link when we're off the mic.
Yeah, that would be great.
But right now, we have to get to our first program, and that's going to be an episode of 20 Questions. And we have the episode called The Mouse That Ran Up the Clock. That just they just take the episode title from the first thing mentioned in the show. This is from Sunday, March 10, 1946, originally over Mutual. And it the host is Bill Slater. Our panelists are Fred Vandeventer, Florence Renard, Bobby McGuire, Herb Palazzi, and E.J. Kahn. And Robert Martin is announcing the show was sustained. And Stu is standing by to give us a little bit more information on 20 Questions. Take it away, sir.
Yeah. Well, 20 Questions has been a popular parlor game which encouraged deductive reasoning and creativity. It originated in the United States and was played widely in the 19th century. It escalated in popularity during the late 1940s when it became the format for a successful weekly radio quiz program. 20 Questions first broadcast at 8 p.m. Saturday, February 2nd, 1946 on the Mutual Broadcasting System from New York's Long Acre Theater on West 48th Street. Radio listeners sent in subjects for the panelists to guess in 20 questions. Winston Churchill's cigar was the subject most frequently submitted. On the early shows, listeners who stumped the panel won a lifetime subscription to Pageant Magazine. From 1946 to 1951, the program was sponsored by Ronson Lighters. In 1952 to 53, Wild Root Cream Oil was the sponsor. Whatever happened to them? Anyway, the show was the creation of Fred Vandeventer, who was a WR radio newscaster with New York's highest-rated news show, Vandeventer and the News. Vandeventer was on the program's panel with his wife, Florence Vandeventer, who used her maiden name appearing on the show as Florence Renard. Their 14-year-old son, Robert Vandeventer, known on the show as Bobby McGuire, and the program's producer, Herb Palazzi, completed the regular panel, with daughter Nancy Vandeventer joining the group on occasions. Celebrity guests sometimes contribute to identifying the subject at hand. The Vandeventer family had played the game for years at their home, long before they brought the game to radio, and they were so expert at it that they could often nail the answer after only six or seven questions. On one memorable show, McGuire succeeded in giving the correct answer, Brooklyn, without asking a single question. The studio audience was shown the answer in advance, and McGuire based his answer on the audience's reaction. During the 1940s, New York radio studio audiences included many Brooklynites, and they cheered wildly whenever Brooklyn was mentioned in any context. The moderator was sportscaster Bill Slater, who opened each session by giving the clue as animal, vegetable, or mineral. They then answered each query from panel members. The cast remained largely intact throughout the decade-long run of the show. Slater was succeeded at the beginning of 1953 by Jay Jackson, who remained through the final broadcast, and there were two changes in the panel's juvenile chair. When McGuire graduated from high school, his decision to attend North Carolina-based Duke University meant he could no longer remain on the program, so he asked his high school friend Johnny McPhee to replace him. Since McPhee was attending nearby Princeton University, he was thus geographically available for the production in New York. McPhee continued until he graduated and was himself succeeded by Dick Harrison, real name John Beebe, in September 1953. Harrison continued until early 1954 when he was replaced by Bobby McGuire, then 22 years old. McGuire appeared as the oldest living teenager until the end of the run.
All right. Thank you, Stu.
More than you ever wanted to know.
Oh, yes, about 20 questions. It's time to get this program started. So if you'll reach for the McGee machine, which I have placed here near you so you don't
have to strain.
And
looks
yeah.
like you've done something different. Did you paint it or polish it up or something?
It must be the flowers on top of it then.
Oh, that's it. It's had a haircut.
Yeah.
Did I push the right knob?
Oh, yeah. I hear the static. That means you've done your job, sir.
Oh.
All right.
I'm good at static.
Yes, you are. All right, folks, so sit back, close your eyes, and remember, 20 questions. This is The Mouse That Ran Up the Clock from Sunday, March 10th, 1946, originally over Mutual.
Is it animal or vegetable?
Is it a living American man?
Would I wear it on my new spring hat?
Is it located in Europe?
Would my Uncle Albert smoke it?
Yes, all America's playing 20 questions. In cooperation with the puzzle and game section of Paget Magazine, Mutual presents 20 questions. And here's Bill Slater.
Thank you, thank you. Hello, everyone. Come on and play 20 questions with us, and here's how you do it. You listeners have sent in subjects that our questioners will try to discover in 20 questions or fewer. If your subject is used, you get a year's subscription to Paget Magazine free. And if your subject can't be named within 20 questions, you get Paget free the rest of your life, plus a grand surprise prize. Our mystery voice offstage in a soundproof booth will tip you at home on what the subject is, while our studio guests here will know from a board that they alone can see. In other words, everybody will be in on the secret except our five eager questioners. Now, our questioners are Fred Vandeventer, well-known New York newscaster, Florence Renard, musician and teacher, Bobby McGuire, amazing 14-year-old schoolboy, Herb Palazzi, radio and motion picture producer, and our special guest tonight is E.J. Kahn, author, humorist, and staff writer on The New Yorker. Glad to have you, Mr. Kahn. Well, everybody seems all ready, so let's get going right away. My first subject was sent in by Shirley Hartstein, whose home is in St. Louis, Missouri, and this subject is animal.
This is the mystery voice tipping you of the radio audience off to the fact that the subject is the mouse that ran up the clock.
All right, you at home know what it is. The audience knows what it is. Let's see if our five questioners can get it. Here goes Vandeventer.
Is it a living American man?
No, it's not a living American man. Miss Renard.
Is it a human being?
It's not a human being. Mr. Palazzi?
Well, is it male or female?
Well, I really don't know. That doesn't matter, I'll tell you that.
You mean it could be neuter gender?
No, I don't think it was that. But it really doesn't matter. You know, I don't know whether it was male or female. Mr. Kahn?
Is it a four-footed animal?
It's a four-footed animal. Vandeventer?
Is it living?
No. Miss Renard?
Is it a fictional animal?
Right.
Is it in a nursery rhyme?
In a nursery rhyme.
Now, a rhyme rather than a story.
That's right. Bobby?
Was in a Mother Goose rhyme.
Was in a Mother Goose rhyme, and let's see how many questions we've used here. We've used only seven questions up to here. Eight up to here. Bobby?
Is this animal edible?
No, Bobby. You wouldn't want to eat this one. Miss Renard?
Does it belong to the cat family?
Not always, Miss Renard. No, it doesn't belong to the cat family. Mr. Palazzi?
Did it do an exceptional feat in this nursery rhyme?
It did an exceptional feat in this nursery rhyme. Vandeventer?
Did he jump over the moon?
No.
No, that's edible.
It didn't jump over the moon. That's edible if you can get it. Yeah. Miss Renard?
You said it was not a four-footed animal.
Oh, I said it was a four-footed animal.
Oh, I see.
That's what I told Mr. Kahn. I always let him in on how many feet everything has got. It did a rather exceptional feat. Having 4 feet. Who has the next question here? It's in a Mother Goose rhyme. Miss Renard?
Is it a dog?
No, I'm sorry. It's not a dog. That's 13 questions now. Vandeventer?
Is it of the canine family?
No. No. It's not related to a dog, even. Mr. Kahn?
Is it related to a horse?
No. No. I don't think there's any relationship between this thing and a horse. Bobby?
Will it be classed as a beast of burden?
No, he can't carry anything much. It's too small for that. Mr. Palazzi?
Did it ever run up and down a clock?
It certainly did.
Well, it's a little mousey.
It ran up and down the clock. Well, that took you 18 questions, but that's not an easy subject to get. Let's try the next one, which was sent in by Robert Oster, whose home is in New York City. For that, he gets a year's subscription to Paget Magazine free, and this subject is animal also.
Bill's subject is right in front of the panel. It's the studio audience.
All right, everybody knows what it is now except our five questioners, and this is a rather unusual subject. Who wants to start after it? Mr. Van de Venner?
Is it a human being?
Oh, partly. Yes, it's a human. It's human. It's human. Mr. Palazzi?
Would I sit on it? You said partner. I don't know what...
You might try it, but I don't think it would work. Mr. Kahn?
Is it living?
Wonder what the audience thinks. Sure, it's living. Mr. Van de Venner?
Is it a man?
Partly. Partly, Miss Renard?
Is this a tangible object?
You mean, can you put your hands on it?
Well, yes.
Yes, sure. I don't intend to do it, but you could. Bobby?
Is this a group of animals, or...
Yes, Bobby, it's a group of animals. Van de Venner?
This is one of my hunches. Is it our audience?
It's the studio audience!
I take back my question. I don't want to sit on the audience. No. I don't want them to sit on me.
By the way, Mr. Palazzi, have your folks come back from Florida yet?
Yes, sir. My mother-in-law's back, and my father-in-law can have her.
Well, Gable's back, too. For that matter, let's move on to our next subject. Lois Kendall of Calumet, Michigan, thought this one up. This one's fairly difficult. It's vegetable.
The panel has 20 chances to guess Sir Walter Raleigh's cape.
Now you at home know. Now the people in the studio audience know. And here's the subject. Here we go. Miss Renard?
Is this vegetable in its natural state?
No, it's not. Miss Kahn?
Is it edible?
No. I wouldn't advise. Bobby?
Is it wooden?
No. Miss Renard?
Is it paper?
No. Mr. Blazing?
Is it wood?
I asked that.
Would it be wood?
Well, now, look, if it would be wood, I'd have said it was wooden. Wouldn't I?
Yes, you would.
I'm not going to charge you for that question. I said no, it wasn't.
No. Is Van this Bennett? A class question?
No. It's a specific thing we're after. Van de Venner again?
Is it in the United States?
No. Bobby?
Does it exist?
Today, no.
Was it American?
No, it was not American. Miss Renard?
Did it exist in fiction?
In fiction, and it is believed by a great many people that it may have existed in reality, too.
It was written about.
Yes. And talked about considerably. Van de Venner?
Was it ancient?
What do you mean by ancient? And don't look at me when you answer.
Well, I should say that any time from biblical time on back, I would call
no,
ancient.
No, not back that far at all. Miss Kahn?
Was it European?
It was European. Miss Blaise?
Did it belong to a ruler?
No. No, it did not belong to a ruler. But a ruler used it once. Van de Venner?
Was it French?
No, it was not French. Miss Renard?
Was it in Southern Europe?
No.
How many questions is that?
That's 14 questions. We've got it pretty well narrowed down, though, haven't we? Van de Venner?
Was this a fairly large object?
Not too large. It was not a small object, but it was not too large. What do you mean by large? Big as an elephant? Thinking of the circus coming to town?
Well, yes.
It wasn't as large as an elephant, no. Bobby?
Was this an article of wearing apparel?
It was an article of wearing apparel.
Was it English?
It was English.
Was it Sir Walter Raleigh's coat?
It was Sir Walter Raleigh's coat. Bobby, how do you get that way? You just get that look on your face and you go shooting right through and grab it. Van de Venner?
I would just like to observe in passing that I think it's open to question whether that's vegetable or not.
Oh, I think so. I imagine.
Well, wool would, of course, wool would be animal, and so would velvet, I believe.
Well, I don't know, frankly, whether it was vegetable or animal.
I just mentioned in passing.
Yeah. I thought it was vegetable, and there are a group of people in a certain library in New York, I think, are still arguing about it. I started them on it this morning.
That's very
Bobby's
good.
A pretty smart boy.
I should say he is smart.
Where were you when I was trying to make out my income tax?
Well, let's move to subject number four here. Thought up by Robert E. Bartman, whose home is in Boonton, New Jersey. He gets a year's subscription to Pageant because we're using it, and this subject is vegetable.
The fun will begin as soon as I tell you on the QT that the subject is Bobby McGuire's report card.
See how many questions it takes us to get this. Vandeventer?
Is this in its natural state?
Is this in its natural state? No. It's had things done to it. Mr. Palazzi?
Well, is it famous for the person who owns it?
Well, it's known for the person who owns it.
It's known for the person
yes.
who owns it.
Sometimes famous and sometimes maybe not. Mr. Vandeventer?
Is it wooden?
No. Mr. Kahn?
This isn't wearing apparel again.
No, you can't wear this. You'd get mighty cold. Miss Renard?
Is this paper?
It's paper.
Is it a document?
I think you would call it a document, but in no historical sense. Vandeventer?
Is it a legal paper, then, of some sort?
No, it's not a legal paper. I'm going to just group that all in as one question. Bobby?
Is this a sign?
A sign?
Yeah.
No. No. Mr. Blaze.
Is it an advertisement of some kind?
Well, that's what I meant by this. That's what I meant, by a sign.
No, it doesn't advertise anything, at least not for the public. Vandeventer?
Is this just one document or paper, whatever it is
yes.
we're after?
Yes. Miss Renard?
Is it American?
Oh, yes. Bobby?
Does this have anything to do with a magazine?
Well, no. But if you fool with magazines too much, why, it's reflected on this thing that I'm talking about. Everybody's looking very puzzled now.
Will you say that again, just what you said?
I think I'd just well leave it unsaid, Mr. Vandeventer. Glad you didn't hear it, Bobby.
Is this some kind of money?
No, it's not some kind of money.
Well,
although sometimes you can buy things with it, I've been told. I don't know. But disregard that, too. Just excuse me, I'm just sitting here drooling. Mr. Vandeventer?
Is this paper printed upon as distinguished from written upon?
It's both.
Both writing and printing?
Yes, sir.
In other words, somebody has signed it or something of that sort.
Well, we hope so. Yes. Now, let me see how many questions we have here. That's 13. Mr. Palazzi?
Is it a check?
No, sorry. Not a check. It can't be stretched that far. Miss Renard?
Does nearly everyone have one of these?
At one time or another in his life, yes. Bobby?
Is this red tape or anything like that?
No.
Would you say that it's not a specific thing, but more or less of a group of things put together?
No, it's one specific thing, Bobby.
Did you say it did belong to a famous person?
I said it belongs to a person, yes. This one we're after is particularly known for the person it belongs to. Although, I noticed I said it was not historical or famous. Vandeventer?
How many questions is that, please?
That's 16 questions. We have 4 to go.
I can't waste very many, then, can I?
No.
Is this printing on it colored in any way, or is it just plain black and white?
It's usually just black and white. Mr. Vandeventer?
Is it connected with the entertainment world?
No, it's not connected with the entertainment world. We have 2 questions to go. It's a fairly tough subject to get, but you're warmer than you think you are. Mr. Palazzi?
Is it a summons?
No, but it sometimes causes consternation. Now, you've got 1 question left. Here we go. Either you get this one or Robert Hartman out in Boonton, New Jersey is going to get a grand surprise prize. Here you go, Bobby.
This is a guess. Is it Mary Joyce's?
No, I'm awfully sorry. Bobby, it's your report card that we were after. Well, that was a noble effort on a tough subject.
I don't mention my report card.
What'd you say, Bob?
I don't mention my report card.
No, but we do. We're very proud of your report card, as a matter of fact. So Mr. Robert Hartman out in Boonton, New Jersey, gets pageant free for the rest of his life, and in addition, he gets a grand surprise prize of 5 record albums consisting of the latest recorded hits. Congratulations to you, Mr. Hartman. Let's move on now to subject number 5, which was thought up by Carl Canterbury, whose home is in Moline, Illinois. And this subject, we're going to let you people at home play it right along with us. This subject is animals. Here we go. Mr. Vandeventer.
Is it a living American man?
No, it's not.
Is it a living American four-footed animal?
No, it's not. You people trying to get me three questions in one are sort of losing now, Vandeventer.
Well, we'll start out even then. Is it a human being?
It's a human being. Mr. Knight.
Is he American?
Yes. Grudgingly, I say yes. Mr. Kahn?
Was that yes to that whole question?
Is he American?
It's a he, too. That we can assume that.
Well, thanks to my stupidity, I guess you can.
Okay.
Slipped the sex classification in on me, didn't you, Mr. Kahn? You're awfully happy about it. Vandeventer?
Was he connected with the government?
Yes. Yes. One phase of the government. Miss Renard?
Is he living?
No. Bobby?
Did he have anything to do with the United States around, 25 years either side of 1800?
25 years either side of 1800? Wait till I use my fingers, Bobby. Yes. Vandeventer?
Was he a military figure?
He was a military figure. Miss Renard?
Was it Benedict Arnold?
It was Benedict Arnold. Well, our people got it here in exactly 9 questions. I wonder how you people at home did. If you did better than 9 questions on getting Benedict Arnold, why, we'd certainly very much like to hear from you. Now let's move into subject number 6. That was good work, Miss Renard. Subject number 6, for which a year's subscription to Paget Magazine is given to Georgianne Ray, whose home is in Woodside, Long Island, and this subject is mineral.
This is the Mystery Voice once more. Bill Slater's mineral subject is the rolling stone that gathers no moss.
This is a fairly difficult one again. Vandeventer is after it.
Is it metallic?
No, it's not metallic.
Is it a precious object?
Not particularly precious, no. Miss Renard?
Is it some formation of stone?
Yes.
Is it in existence?
I think it is, although we don't think of it as something that's confined to whether it existed now or passed away 40
years ago.
Then I
ask another question. Is it biblical?
No.
Is it in the title of a song or story?
In the title of a song or story? It has been in the title of a story that I can remember, and I think it's been in the... Well, it's been in the lyrics of some songs, anyway. It was not primarily known as either the title of a song or the title of a story. Vandeventer?
Is this stone in the United States?
It's more or less placeless, this particular one. You wouldn't associate any locality with it, Mr. Vandeventer.
But I had the Blarney Stone in mind.
Well, I could tell by the way you were puckering your lips that that's the stone you were thinking about. Mr. Kahn?
Is this a particular object we're after or a class of objects?
No, this is a particular one you're after, Miss Renard.
Is this an intangible object or something that is part of a saying or an expression?
Well, now, which one of those questions are you asking me? There were just 3 in there, Miss Renard.
Well, if it were part of a saying, it would be intangible.
It's a part of a saying.
Is it the rolling stone that gathers no moss?
You're too good for me, Miss Renard. I thought that... I lose a bet again on that one. I thought that would stop us. That's very, very good going, I think. Incidentally, you folks at home who have been sending subjects in, keep on sending them in because we need them to stump this very capable group of questioners we have here. I'm thinking of that in connection with the next subject, which was submitted by Mary E. Spies, whose home is in St. Paul, Minnesota. This subject, incidentally, was submitted by many, many people. But we used the one that was postmarked first. And this subject is animal.
The panel tries its luck and its skill on this subject from Greek mythology, Achilles' heel.
All right, here we go. Bobby?
Is it a four-footed animal?
No, it's not. Vandeventer?
Is it a human being?
No, it's not a human being. Miss Renard?
Is it a bird?
No, it's not a bird. Vandeventer?
Is it a part of an animal?
Yes. Vandeventer?
Is it manufactured?
No. Scarcely. Bobby?
Is this part of the animal still part of the animal that it was started out as?
Well, is that a 14-year-old way of saying was it separated from the animal it began with?
That's right.
No, it wasn't. Mr. Palazzi?
Is it part of the front part of the animal?
No, it's not. Vandeventer?
Was it fictional?
Yes. Van again.
Was it written by Shakespeare?
No. Miss Renard?
Was it in a nursery rhyme?
No, it was not. Bobby?
Is this part of a four-footed animal?
No, not part of a four-footed animal. Mr. Pelosi?
Was it written about by Poe?
No. Poe, Mr. Pelosi, was wrong.
How many questions is that?
That's 12 questions. Mr. Kahn?
Is it part of a reptile?
No, not part of a reptile. Everybody is looking pretty hard for this part of an animal.
Well, was this part of an animal then changed by human processes into something else?
No.
By that I mean leather is tanned.
No, this part of the animal was not changed. Miss Renard?
Did we ask if it was fictional?
Yes.
It is.
And
I'm
it
not
is.
Charging you for that.
It is fictional.
Yes.
Was it an American fiction?
No. No. That's 15 questions now, 5 to go, for part of an animal. Miss Kahn?
Was it a fleshy part of an animal?
Was it a what?
A fleshy part of an animal, as opposed to hair, say, or
no.
teeth, or something
you mean,
like that.
Was it flesh?
Yes.
Yes, it was flesh, but not what we call fleshy, ordinarily. Bobby?
You said it wasn't by Shakespeare.
No, it was not by Shakespeare. That I'm not charging you for. This is all just by way of review. Since you're looking for a part of an animal, that's what people have been doing in meat markets for years now without much success. I know you're up against a tough job. Miss Renard?
I don't think anyone asked if it was part of a human being, did we?
No, you just asked about how many feet it had, and all I said was it didn't have four. It's part of a human being, if that's your
Thank
question.
You.
Now we have 3 questions to go. Miss Renard?
Is it, No, I want to ask that. You said it was flesh, didn't you?
Mr. Kahn was into
so
the
wouldn't
flesh
be a beard.
Question. No. Wouldn't be what, miss?
Wouldn't be a beard.
No, wouldn't be a beard. Vandeventer.
Are we, again, trying to identify the portion of the body which can be seen of a certain person? Is that what we're trying to do? That is, are we after somebody's nose or somebody's ears or...
Yes. Yes, I think I've got to charge you for that. You're after somebody something. Bobby?
Is this mythological?
Now, that's question number 19, Bobby, and the answer to that is yes.
Is
There's
it,
only one question left.
Is it Achilles' heel?
It was Achilles' heel. All right. Let's try this one. Lee Fretwell, whose home is in Bluefield, West Virginia, thought this one up. He gets a year's subscription to Pageant because we're using it. This is Animal.
This is the mystery voice to tell you of the radio audience that Bill's subject is from the Bible. It's the dove that Noah released from the ark.
All right, here we go. The people at home know what it is. The people in the studio audience know what it is. Our 5 don't. Let's try to get it. Mr. Pelosi?
Is it fictional?
Fiction?
Yeah, well, is it, created?
What do you mean, created?
Against living? Is it drawn or something?
Well, now, let me see. Let's sort of get one question out of that, Mr. Blasey. I'll answer your first question. Is it fictional? No. Mr. Kahn?
Does it exist?
Today? No.
Yes.
Bobby?
I didn't quite catch it. Did you say it was animal?
It's animal.
Thank you.
Vandeventer?
Is it a human being?
No. Mr. Kahn?
4-footed animal?
No. Miss Renard?
Is this a bird?
This is a bird.
Is it in fiction?
No.
Oh, Mr. Palacios, I'm sorry.
No, but just for alertness and because you've been so good, I'm going to charge you for that.
Well, that's how I expected you to.
Well, thank you, Mr. Vandeventer?
Is this a specific bird that we're after?
This is a specific bird you're after. I hope you get the bird. Mr. Kahn?
Is it a large bird?
No, it's not a large bird. Mr. Palacios?
Is it a parrot?
No. No. Bobby?
How many questions have we used?
We've used 8 questions now. Vandeventer?
Well, distinguishing between a large bird and a small bird, is it as big, let's say, as a parrot?
Well, if it was a little parrot, the answer would be yes. But a big parrot, no. Now you can pair it up in your mind with some other bird and maybe you'll get it. Bobby?
This is one single bird.
One single bird. Yes. That's an interesting question.
Seeing Capistrano there.
Yes.
Has this bird ever been mentioned in the title of a song?
This particular bird has never been mentioned in the title of a song, no. Miss Renard?
Is this bird in existence today?
I answered that question once before, no. I'm not charging you for that.
Was it an American bird?
No. Oh, no. No. Miss Renard?
Was it a Roman bird?
Well, it did some roaming around, but it wasn't a Roman bird, no. No, it was not. Now, that's 17... How many questions, Mr. Martin? That's 14 questions. We have six to go in quest of this particular bird. In other words, six questions for your bird hunting, my friends. Vandevant?
Was it a European bird?
Honestly, I don't know. And I don't know of anybody who does know. So the answer will have to be no, it was not a European bird. Not confined to Europe. Van de Venner again.
Was it the dodo bird?
Was it the dodo bird?
Yes.
No. No.
Well, is it a bird in children's literature?
No, it's not a bird in children's literature. Now,
well, you said it was not fictional. Questions. Didn't you?
I said it was not fictional. Miss Renard.
Was it in the Bible?
It was in the Bible.
Was it the bird that Noah sent out to...
It was the dove that Noah sent out from the ark. Well, you know, my hat is off to you. I reached just as deeply as I could for that one and the one before it, too, because you're in amazing form tonight. Now let's try it.
That was a dove, I think.
It was a dove.
If the audience wants to know whether we know or not.
It was a dove, yes. Everybody knew when you got in that close. Of course, I believe Noah did send out a raven first and then sent this dove out three times. This is a Saturday night Sunday school lesson for you people.
Why, were you there with him, Slater?
No, I wasn't. They went two by two then. Now, let's move into this department. I've got a few quickies here that I've thought up myself, and we'll let you see how you can do, not in relation to the number of questions, but how much time it takes you to get this one. This first one is animal.
Bill's subject is the big gorilla of the big top, Gargantua.
All right, here we go. Bobby?
Is it a living American man?
Living American man? No.
Is she in the entertainment world?
Yes.
You said she. He said she, didn't he?
Well, the subject's in the entertainment world. I'm not giving you away the she or the he business free.
Is she on the radio?
No.
Is she in the sports world?
No.
Is she in the movies?
No.
Is it a woman?
No.
Is it alive?
Your boy. It sure is.
Is he an athlete?
Not primarily known as an athlete, no.
Is it a man?
No.
You said this thing was not in the movies?
That's right.
Was it in the circus?
It's in the circus. Go ahead.
Gargantua?
It's Gargantua. That's very good. Well, you've got Gargantua in 52 seconds, Mr. Palazzi, which is, I think, very, very good going.
I ate my dinner tonight at 48.
Let's see if we can get this next one in 40 seconds. This one is mineral, animal, and a little vegetable.
I'm here off stage to tell you that the subject is Walker Cooper's baseball mask.
See if we can get this in 40 seconds. It's a toughie.
Is it a body of water?
No.
Is it a section of land?
No.
Is it edible?
No.
Is it a class question?
No.
Is it a structure?
No.
No, what's that?
No.
Is it manufactured?
Yes.
Is it a method of transportation?
No. Who's next?
Is it something you'd have around your house?
Not normally.
Does it have anything to do with the sports world?
It has to do with the sports world. Take one quick guess.
Is it a baseball?
Is baseball?
Yes, it's in baseball. As a matter of fact, it's Walker Cooper's baseball mask. We haven't any more time to give to you on it. Next week, friends, we'll be playing 20 questions again at the same time over most of these stations. And if you've enjoyed our program, you'll enjoy reading Paget Magazine on sale at all newsstands. Now, here's Robert Martin to tell you how to submit your subjects, Bob.
Thank you, William Slater. Just write the name of the subject to be identified on a postcard. Mail it with your name and address to 20 questions in care of the Mutual Broadcasting System, New York 18. A year subscription to Paget Magazine will be awarded for any subject used. In case of duplication or similarity, the decision of our judges will be final and all entries become our property. Should you submit some subject that cannot be identified by our questioners within 20 questions, you'll receive a special surprise prize plus a lifetime subscription to Paget Magazine. Tune in again next week when Fred Vandeventer, Florence Renard, Herb Palazzi, Bobby McGuire, and our guest questioner try to identify the subjects you suggest. If you hear someone say, "I can hardly wait for Monday," we'll tell you the reason why. It's Lombardo, Cougat, and James on the new 1946 Spotlight Vans. If you're one who walks around humming, "He's my guy," that's Guy Lombardo. We're making with the sweetest music this side of heaven, Lombardo's own, every Monday. Or if you're a person who likes to whistle with a Latin lilt to your tunes, that's also on order. Xavier Cugat, the Rumba King, every Wednesday night on Spotlight.
If swing's the thing, well, it's Harry James, home James, yes. Pass around the word that Harry James will be around on Friday nights with his music makers. Lombardo, Cugat, and James, all three on the new Spotlight bands. I can hardly wait for Monday when Mutual draws the curtain for Guy Lombardo on Spotlight. So join us then, won't you? Same time, same Mutual station. Bob Martin speaking. This is the Mutual Broadcasting System.
Top of the morning to you. This is Arthur Anderson. But let's pretend I'm Lucky the Leprechaun. You're listening to the Glowin' Dial. Oh, you like the Glowin' Dial. For us, said Arthur Anderson, it's magically nostalgic. That doesn't quite scan, does it? But you know what I mean.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of 20 Questions. That was The Mouse That Ran Up the Clock from Sunday, March 10, 1946, originally over Mutual. And we have three more game shows we're going to bring you. But right now, it's time for that celebratory portion of the program. And I think we should just let the music speak for itself. Ladies and gentlemen, once more on the Glowing Dial, it is time for the celebrity birthday list, and here with that thankless, arduous task is the man himself, Mr. Stu Chisholm. Take it away, sir.
Oh, thank you, Johnny. And I want to start out on that moon landing date of July 20th with the birthday of Verna Felton. She's an actor from Seal Test Village Store, the Judy Canova Show, and the Jack Benny Program. Then on the 21st is Hyman Brown, actor, producer, The Inner Sanctum Mysteries, and CBS Radio Mystery Theater. On the 22nd, you share a birthday, if that is your birthday, with Major George Fielding Elliott, CBS military analyst during World War II. And on July 23rd, Jackson Beck's birthday is being celebrated. Actor and announcer Philo Vance and casebook of Gregory Hood. On July 24th, Raymond Edward Johnson's birthday is being celebrated. Actor, host of Inner Sanctum Mysteries, Don Winslow on Don Winslow of the Navy. And on the 25th is Harold Peary's birthday. Actor Throckmorton P. Gildersleeve on Fibber McGee and Molly and The Great Gildersleeve. On July 26th, one of my favorites, Gracie Allen, comedian, Adventures of Gracie, and the George Burns and Gracie Allen Show. Then on July 27th, it's Barbara Eiler's birthday, actor in the life of Riley and the day in the life of Dennis Day. July 28th is Bill Goodwin's birthday, actor, announcer, the George Burns and Gracie Allen Show. And then July 29th, Professor Irwin Corey is throwing some confetti, actor Edgar Bergen and the Charlie McCarthy Show. July 30th, Gordon Hughes, the director of Lights Out and The Guiding Light. And if I can get to the next page in time. All right, on the 31st, Kurt Gowdy, the sportscaster, is celebrating his birthday. He did the play-by-play for the Boston Red Sox. On August 1st is Alan Frost's birthday, actor Mr. and Mrs. North, Woman of Courage, and Mercury Theater. August 2nd is Hal Block's birthday, writer Burns and Allen, Milton Berle Show, and a panelist on What's My Line. August 3rd is Marilyn Maxwell's birthday, singer, actor, Kraft Music Hall, Abbott and Costello Show, and the Bob Hope Show. And Christopher Tabori's birthday is on August 4th, and he's an actor from CBS Radio Mystery Theater. On August the 5th is Parley Bear. I knew I was going to get that wrong. It's Parley Bear, actor famous for Gunsmoke and Rogers of the Gazette. And on August 6th is Lucille Ball's birthday, comedian, my favorite husband, and I love Lucy. And on August 7th, it's my birthday, so save up. Send in your presents. And also Stan Freeberg's birthday, comedian, that's Rich, and the Stan Freeberg Show. August 8th is Terry Nation, comedy writer, The Goon Show, created by... And he created the Daleks for Doctor Who. And on August 9th, Don Bernard, director, Blondie, Life of Riley, and Meet Mr. Meek. So if you share any of those birthdays, somebody famous shares it with you. Just made it.
Yeah, you just made it. You're getting better at that, though, you know?
Well, you know.
I know it's a challenge. 21 birthdays in that, I don't know, what is it, three and a half minutes of the tune there.
I like the tune. We really gotta make a special glowing dial edit of that.
Actually, that is the glowing dial edit that you did for me.
Oh.
Extended.
That's right. I'm thinking more of the... Well, you know, I'm thinking more of the other parts. There's some other parts. We need to really jazz it up.
All right, I call that a task to put on our bucket list.
There you go.
All right, folks, we have three more game shows to bring you. We're going to get to all of that and more right after this. Hi, Big John here to tell you about the greatest internet experience you'll ever have. And I'm talking about the Glowing Dial page. And to get there, all you have to do is simply point your browser to www.glowingdial.com. It couldn't be any easier. The Glowing Dial page is the internet presence for our old-time radio show, The Glowing Dial. There are so many things to see and do at the Glowing Dial page, we don't have time to list them all. But here's a few. Read mini bios of Steve, Stu, and myself and find out how the show came to be. Enter our latest contest and win a neat prize. Visit the photo gallery and view images of myself, Stu, and Steve, as well as some of our friends and OTR celebrities, too. Stop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Subscribe to our new podcast and also enjoy classic episodes of The Glowing Dial. You can also subscribe to our blog and discussion list and keep up with all the latest Glowing Dial news and information. Stop by the Glowing Dial online store and purchase a wide variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. All that and more awaits you at the Glowing Dial page at www.glowingdial.com. See you there! And we are back, folks. It's time for our next game show in this playing games with you version of the Glowing Dial. It's an episode of the Ask It Basket, and the episode is called What is a Ruminant? Again, they just took the title from the first question asked in the show. This is from Thursday, September 21st, 1939, originally over CBS. Jim McWilliams is our host. Del Sharbat is announcing. The sponsor is Colgate. And the panelists were a stenographer, a sailor, a buyer, and a student chosen from the studio audience. Now, standing by with some more information on the Ask It Basket is Stu Chisholm.
Yeah, thanks. Well, this show ran from October 5th, 1938 into about October 1940. Jim McWilliams, the original host of the Ask It Basket, was billed as radio's original question and answer man by virtue of having worked on one of the earliest quiz shows, Uncle Jim's Question Bee, on the Blue Network in 1936. The Ask It format was simple. McWilliams chose four contestants from the audience and put them through a series of questions sent in by listeners. The level of questions seemed to increase in difficulty. The first level might be multiple choice. For example, if you were told that your parsimonious proclivities predominate perceptively, would you be a mountain climber, a miser, or a music lover? A lot of alliteration there, eh?
Yes.
The second level, translating of poetry, announcer Del Sharbat would kept a running total of points scored, and the winner got a $25 grand prize with $10 to the runner-up and $5 for third. Now those aren't even good tips for cab drivers. The hapless contestant who finished out of the money was consoled with platitudes. Gosh, it's too bad you got all the tough ones, and was given a final round four questions for a chance at a buck per correct answer. And so that's the Ask It Basket.
All right. We try to bring you as much information as we can, but sometimes that's all there is available. So I'm going to have you, sir, reach for the McGee machine, and we're going to tune this episode in.
Again?
Nothing up your sleeve.
I don't have
Presto.
Sleeves. Maybe I have sleeves today.
No doubt about it. We're going to have to get another McGee machine. There we go. Thank you, buddy. Yeah. he's not allowed to. He's not even allowed to go, yeah. But all right. Okay, I see you're manipulating our dial, and where's our... There we go. There's our static. Familiar static.
I wasn't manipulating a dial.
Kids, a family show. Anyway, folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember the Ask It Basket. This is What is a Ruminant from Thursday, September 21, 1939, originally over CBS.
The Colgate Ask It Basket, on the air with Jim McWilliams, radio's original question and answer man. Jim has picked four contestants from the volunteers in the audience. They're all raring to go. Well, now let's see. They are a sailor, a student, a stenographer, and a department store buyer. And they're all competing in this friendly and amusing contest for three cash prizes and answering questions that come from your hometown and mine. And here he comes, Genial Jim McWilliams.
Thank you and good evening, everybody, and a big welcome to you all. Are your hands all clean?
Yeah.
Are your faces clean?
Yeah.
And I'm sure your teeth are clean, too, if you use Colgate Dental Cream. Am I right, Del?
Absolutely, Jim. They're double clean, because Colgate Dental Cream does double duty. First, Colgate's active yet safe polishing agent brings out the natural brilliance of teeth, makes them sparkle. Second, Colgate's penetrating foam gets between teeth, helps the toothbrush clean out neglected food particles that often cause unpleasing breath. So friends, remember, get teeth really clean, outside and in between. Change to Colgate Dental Cream. Buy a tube tomorrow. All right, Jim, on with our Ask It Basket.
Okay, Del, but first I've got to give myself a couple of squeaks on the buzzer. Last week I said that Brooklyn was not a borough of the city of New York. It is. I'm sorry, all you loyal Brooklynites, and thanks for calling it to my attention. And now, for Colgate Ask It Basket number one, our first contestant, a very charming young lady, comes to the microphone. Your name, please?
Sylvia Fisher.
Sylvia Fisher. Where are you from, Sylvia?
Brooklyn.
Brooklyn. And what is your business?
Stenographer.
You're a stenographer. All right. Will you choose a question and hand it over? We're very happy to have you on this program, Miss Fisher. And this question comes from Bordentown, New Jersey. Miss Celia A. Gaskell asks, if you were in the market for a ruminant, R-U-M-I-N-A-N-T, would you go to a stockyard, a bargain counter, or a secondhand bookshop? Right into the microphone. And speak right up.
What is that?
Would you go to a stockyard, a bargain counter, or a secondhand bookshop for a ruminant?
For a ruminant? How do you spell that?
R-U-M-I-N-A-N-T.
A stockyard.
You'd go to a stockyard. Why? Well, you've guessed it correctly. That is correct. All right, thank you. A ruminant is a cow or a camel or a deer or any animal that chooses cud. And our next contestant is a sailor in the United States Navy. What's your name, sailor?
Peter Wershing.
Peter Wershing. Where are you from, Peter?
USS Helena, Brooklyn Navy Yard.
Well, we're very glad to have you on this program. What's your rate?
Flying first class.
Right into the microphone.
Flying first class.
Well, choose a question there, Pete, and hand it over here. Thank you very, very much. Now, this question comes from Arlington, Massachusetts. Mrs. I. M. Shulkin asks, if you were told that your parsimonious proclivities predominate perceptibly, would you be a mountain climber, a miser, or a music lover if you were parsimonious? If you were parsimonious, would you be a mountain climber, a miser, or a music lover? Take your pick, Pete.
Well, I think I'd be a...
A mountain climber, a miser, or a music lover?
Miser.
A miser. You've guessed correctly. All right. A miser is correct. All right. Our next contestant, your name?
Thelma Furman.
Miss or Mrs.?
Mrs.
And where are you from?
Bronx, New York.
The Bronx in New York. And what is your business?
Buyer.
Your Bronx friends are out there giving you a cheer.
I hope it's not a Bronx cheer.
They're not the Bronx, you know, they're just giving you a cheer. Will you choose a question, Andover? We're very happy to have you here. And this question comes from Glenwood, Iowa. Arthur Lloyd wants to know, which is longer, a yard or a meter?
A meter.
A meter. How much longer? Do you have any idea? You are correct.
I don't know.
You don't know. All right. Well, a meter is 39.37 inches, and a meter. That's a meter, and a yard, 36 inches. All right. And our next contestant, your name?
Carter Strong.
Carter Strong. Where are you from, Carter?
I'm from Winchester, Virginia.
Winchester, Virginia. And some of your fellow Virginians are giving you the Virginian cheer. And we're very happy to have you here. What is your business?
I'm a student in the Shenandoah Valley Academy.
Well, choose a question, Carter, and hand it over here. Good luck to you. This question comes from, let me see, Springfield, Ohio. H.E. Bogus wants to know, if your tympanum needed attention or correction, would you send for a dentist, an ear specialist, a drummer, or a mechanic? If your tympanum needed attention, would
tympanum?
Mm-hmm. Would you send for a drummer, an ear specialist, a dentist, or a mechanic?
I'd send for a drummer.
You'd send for a drummer. I am sorry. Who would he send for, audience? An ear specialist, for the tympanum is the eardrum. All right, and here is Asket Basket number 2, and here comes Miss Sylvia Fisher, our very petite sonographer from Brooklyn, New York, choosing a question from Minnetonka, New Jersey. Mrs. Mary Costa wants you to translate the following proverb. It is the final bit of dried grass that affixed to the burden previously acquired induces fracture of the dorsal portion of the ship of the desert. Mm. Now, let's take the... That might sound a bit confusing, but it's really very simple. Now, what is a ship of the desert? Enter the microphone, please. What is a ship of the desert? You give up on that? It's not a Chesterfield.
No, I guess not.
What is it?
I don't know.
You give up on that. Say good and loud, I give up.
I give up.
Well, well, well. What is it, audience? Yes, sir. It's the last... This means... It's the last straw that breaks the camel's back. All right, next contestant, please. Come along, sailor. Come up here, Peter, and choose a question. That's the stuff. Now, this question, Pete, comes from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Dorothy R. Walsh wants you to please just let the question there. That's it. Let's stay right there, I mean, say. Can you name the 3 musical numbers suggesting the 3 colors of the American flag? Now, can you name these 3 musical numbers suggesting the 3 colors of the American flag? The first one.
He's playing high ho.
High ho. All right. What's that from? What's that from?
From the dwarves.
Yeah. Well, what's the name of it? Snow what?
Snow White and the Seven Dwarves.
All right. All right. Now, what colors does that suggest of the flag? That's white, doesn't it?
White.
White. All right, white. Now the next one. The next one. You know what that is? What is it, audience? Beautiful Lady in Blue. All right, that's blue. Now, let's try the next one.
Beautiful
melody. What color would you say? We've had white and blue. Now, what's the other one?
Lady in Red.
Attaboy. All right. Where's the boy sailor? Hurrah for the Navy. All right. And here comes Mrs. Furman. Now, from West Palm Beach, Florida, H.M. Young wants you to pronounce the following word. Now, be careful. This is more or less of a trick question. Here's the word. S-O-M-E-T-I-M-E-S. What does that spell?
Could you spell it over,
please? S-O-M-E-T-I-M-E-S. Please, audience.
Sometimes.
Sometimes. That is correct. All right. Come along, Mr. Strong. Our student, choose a question there, young lad. That's this stuff. And this question comes from the Bronx in New York. And Jack Brandon wants to know, how many hearts are there on the 10 of hearts?
There are 12 hearts in the 10 of hearts.
That is correct. Will you explain that, please?
There are two. There's one underneath.
Write the microphone.
There's one underneath each number, and there are 10 other hearts in the 10 of hearts.
That is correct. 12 is correct. All right. And that finishes Asket Basket number 2. Now, Dell, how about those scores? We want to see who's ahead in this Colgate Asket Basket game.
Sure, Jim. But here's a word everyone is interested in, too. You know, there are many reasons why some people succeed in business and romance. Why many others fail is often obvious. It's because they have unpleasing breath, that's why. And as your own dentist will verify, improperly cleaned teeth are often the cause. So to avoid offending, you'd better clean your teeth 2 ways. And for this double job, use Colgate Dental Cream. Colgate's active foam gets between teeth, helps your toothbrush clean out food particles that often cause unpleasing breath. And Colgate's safe polishing agent polishes teeth to natural brilliance, makes them sparkle. So clean your breath while cleaning your teeth. 2 jobs, 1 price. Start using Colgate Dental Cream tomorrow. All right, folks, here are the scores at the end of Ask It Basket number two. Mrs. Selma Furman is leading with a score of 200 points.
And there's the bell for Ask It Basket number three, and Miss Fisher is at the microphone choosing a question which comes from Aurora, Illinois. Margaret Klessen wants to know, in that part of the United States where it is used, when does daylight saving time go into effect? And how long is it enforced? Now, when does daylight savings time go into effect?
The last Sunday in
April. Into
the microphone. The last Sunday in April.
Uh-huh. Now, and when is it over?
The last Sunday in September.
That is correct. That is correct. The last Sunday in April, and it's over the last Sunday in September. All right, here comes the Navy. All right, oh boy. Pete has chosen a question which comes from Greenville, Texas. Mrs. Mabel Bruce wants you to give the meaning of the following alphabetical combination. FBI.
FBI is the Federal Bureau of Investigation.
That is correct. All right. Now, this might be a little bit hard, but I don't think it will be for you, Pete. Now, how about the NYA?
Is the National Veterans Association.
No, that's... No. NYA.
Oh.
Uh-huh. All right, stay with us, sailor.
National...
The National what? Well, I'm sorry we have to go along on that. Let's try... What is it, audience? National Youth Administration. Now, how about the USNRF?
United States Naval Fleet Reserve.
Well, we had to turn... All right. I'm going to turn that around for you, sailor. USNFR. What is that?
United States Naval Fleet Reserve.
All right. That is correct. All right. We had it to be... And now comes Mrs. Furman. Now, from New Albany, Indiana, Mrs. Bessie Goodham wants you to give the sum of the numbers mentioned in the following song title. She sends this musical question. Now, the first is... What is that? Yum da da dee da da dee da dum dum yum dum dee dee. You have any idea?
Seven.
I'm sorry. What is it, audience? Three little fishes. All right, now let's try the next.
Two.
All right, that's three and two. All right, now the next. Give up on that one?
Seven.
Seven what?
Seven's a lucky number.
Seven's a lucky number, yes, but what's the name of that song?
I can't think of
Three Little Fishes first, Two Sleepy People next, that's three and two, and the next one is what? What's the name of the song?
I don't know the name of the
Give
song.
Up on that. What is it, audience? Two Cigarettes in the Dark, and seven was the correct answer, but we can't give you full credit. All right, there you are, and here comes Carter Strong. Come along. Choose a question, Carter. Our student from Winchester chooses a question from Harding, Massachusetts. Esther A. Hinckley wants to know, what are three copper or bronze coins used in English money? What are the three copper or bronze coins used in English money?
The penny.
Yes.
And the 2 cent piece.
Well, I figured guessing a bit there. Carter, a penny. Well, a penny is worth 2 cents in our money. Now, what corresponds to a 1 cent piece? That is 1 cent in our money.
Pence.
I'm sorry about that. Penny, a penny, and one more, worth a quarter of a cent.
Farthing.
A farthing. All right. A quarter of a penny. All right. And here, oh, my. And there's the bell for Colgate Ask It Basket number four. Sylvia Fisher comes to the microphone, choosing a question which comes from Appleton, New York. Mrs. John Callaghan wants you to tell our friends, how old must a man be to become president of the United States? That's a very easy question. How old must he be?
There's no certain age.
There's no certain age?
No.
Could a man 21 years of age become president?
No. I think he has to be past 30.
He has to be in his 30s.
30s.
I see. Well, I'm sorry about that. You're going to get a squeak. How old, audience? 35.
But, friends, there's no age limitation on a winning smile. Sparkling teeth belong to people of every age who use Colgate Dental Cream. You see, Colgate's safe polishing agent erases cloudy surface film, makes teeth sparkle. And Colgate's penetrating foam helps the toothbrush remove hidden food particles from tiny crevices between teeth. So, for cleaner teeth, brighter smiles, start using Colgate Dental Cream tomorrow. All right, Jim, we'll continue with basket four.
All right, here comes our sailor up to the microphone, choosing a question which comes from, let me see, this one comes from Detroit, Michigan. Mrs. Harry Volker, this is sort of a trick question. What one thing do you have, find, take, pass, do, mark, waste, kill, and make? What one thing do you have, and you find, and you take, and you pass, and you do, and you mark, and you waste, and you kill, and you make?
Oh, time!
Right! Come back here, sir. That was time. Time is correct. All right, that's fine. Thank you. All right, and now, Mrs. Furman, from Boston, Massachusetts, Miss Frances W. Sprague wants you to identify the following quotation. I quote, as idle as a painted ship upon a painted ocean. Please, audience, some more that is in a good south wind sprung up behind, the albatross did follow, and every day for food or play came to the mariner's hollow.
It's the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner.
That is correct. All right, that is fine. Thank you. All right, and here comes Mr. Strong. Choose a question, Mr. Strong. And this question comes from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Miss Kitty Gallagher says, this song that you sometimes hear at weddings is from which of the following operas? Robin Hood, Carmen, Romeo and Juliet, or the Mikado? Here's the tune. Is it from Robin Hood, Carmen, Romeo and Juliet, or the Mikado? Take your pick. Please, audience, take your pick.
Am I repeating those?
Robin Hood, Carmen, Romeo and Juliet, or the Mikado?
Yep. Robin Hood.
Robin Hood is correct. All right, all right, all right.
Hey, wait a minute, Jim. You mind? Let me ring the bell this time, will you?
All right, go ahead.
Well, let me have it, then. Hear ye, hear ye. It's Jim McWilliams' Anything Can Happen basket.
Step right up, folks. Listen closely. Hurry, hurry, hurry. It's amazing. It's colossal. It's just downright funny, maybe. Because anything can happen now. All set, let it go. And here comes Miss Sylvia Fisher. Now, you are a radio actress, and you have one word to say, and that is ah. Ah, no more, no less. But there are three different situations. They're all different. And remember, put yourself in the proper frame of mind for your big dramatic moment. Are you all ready?
Ready.
Are you ready? All right.
Yes.
Now, you have just finished a nice, long, cool drink on a real hot day.
Ah.
Oh, into the microphone.
Ah.
All right. The doctor says, open your mouth and say, ah. All right. And your best beau has just given you a sweet kiss. All right. And here comes the Navy. All right. Choose a question there, Pete. Come on, choose one. That's the stuff. Anyway, they're all right. Well, now, you're now a musical comedy actor. This question comes from Denver, Colorado, and Hattie Sorens wants to see how well you can act in a musical comedy. You are one of the leading characters, and your lines will tell you The songs will tell you your lines. Now, the curtain. It's a beautiful midsummer's night. Find John and Molly in a garden. And these two things in particular help to put John in a very romantic mood.
Moonlight and roses.
Oh, I know, but real, real dramatic.
Moonlight and roses.
All right, that's fine. So John proposes to Molly saying,
let me call you sweetheart. I'm in love with you.
Run into the microphone.
Let me call you sweetheart. I'm in love with you.
All right. Now tell me, after listening to the third song, did Molly say yes or no to John's proposal several years ago?
Well, it's Molly and me, and I guess it's yes.
Yes, just Molly and me, and the baby makes three. All right, all right. All right. Thank you, Sailor. That's great. All right. And here comes Miss Furman. Now, Mrs. Furman, in this musical test, we're going to combine a group of musical numbers, motifs we call them, which will tell you the story of a modern screen classic. Now, the first is... What is that?
It's a spring song.
All right, that's the spring motif. Now, the next number... I'm sorry about that. What is it, audience?
Autumn.
Spanish town, all right. It's spring in a Spanish town. Now? What is that, please? Yes?
Wait a minute.
All right. Just... Right the microphone.
Give it again, will you? It's from the opera Il Trovatore.
Oh,
hi,
I know.
Pagliacci.
Pagliacci. No, try another one. Anyone. It's all right. What is it, audience? All right, Carmen, the Toreador song, and that's the bull. Now, the next is... You give up on that?
Wait a minute. Let me hear that once again.
What is that, audience? The flowers that bloom in the spring color. Now, the next. You know what that is?
No.
What is it, audience? Tree. That's the tree motive. Now, the next one. What is that? Give up on that? What is it, audience? All right, we had the spring, the Spanish town, the bull, the flower, the tree, and the bumblebee. What's the movie classic? What is it, audience? Ferdinand the Bull. All right. Next, please. And here comes Mr. Strong, and this question comes from Brooklyn, New York, and Philip Shinen wants to find out if you can say this tongue twister quickly five times. And here it is. Billy's black beagle bays bee by bow. Billy's black beagle bays bee by bow.
Billy's black beagle bays bee by bow. Billy's black beagle bays bee by bow. Billy's big...
Billy's black beagle...
Billy's black beagle bays bee by bow.
Now, really quick.
Billy's bays... No, Billy's... Billy's black beagle bays bee by bow.
All right. Thank you very, very, very much. Well. The man with the stopwatch is signaling me, and that means time is running short, so no more questions. Sorry, children. And while the right honorable judges are licking their pencils and adding up the scores, listen to Del Sharpe.
If you have unpleasing breath, you're not the exception. No, indeed. Dentists tell us this condition affects 7 out of 10 persons over 17. The cause? Well, often it's merely improperly cleaned teeth, easily overcome by this simple safeguard. Start using Colgate Dental Cream. For Colgate's does a double cleaning job. First, Colgate's penetrating foam floods crevices between teeth, helps your toothbrush whisk away food particles that often cause unpleasing breath. Second,
Colgate's gentle polishing agent safely brings out natural luster and makes teeth sparkle. Two jobs, one price. Enjoy this double advantage. Tomorrow, start using Colgate Dental Cream. And now, back to Jim McWilliams.
How about sending me those questions you've been thinking up? See if you can baffle our Ask It Basket contestants. Send your questions to me, Jim McWilliams, care of the Columbia Broadcasting System, New York City. And if they're used, Colgate will award you a year's supply of Colgate Dental Cream. And here are the winners. Third place goes to Miss Selma Furman, the buyer from the Bronx. $5 to Miss Furman. Carter Strong, the student from Winchester, Virginia, second. $10 to Carter Strong. And the grand prize, $25, goes to Peter Wersing, the fireman first class of the United States Navy. There you are. Congratulations, Peter, and there's your $25. All right, little boy. And now, Miss Fisher, come right up to the microphone. Too bad you had to pick the hard ones tonight, and here's a chance to redeem yourself and get in on the prize money, too. Just answer these questions, and for each one you get right, we'll give you $1, and Del Sharbert, that handsome boy right over there on your right, is ready to give it to you right now. Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay, let's go. Now, from Clinton, Massachusetts, Miss Rose Murphy wants to know, is a peeler a bird, a policeman, or a device for paring potatoes?
A device for paring potatoes.
Right at the microphone.
A device for paring potatoes.
I'm sorry, it's a policeman in England. All right, now, from Richmond, Virginia, Ann Alsop wants to know, a farmer going to Chicago. Pay attention now. Concentrate. Are you concentrating?
Mm-hmm.
All right. All right. A farmer going to Chicago met seven friends with their wives. Each wife had a child by the hand. How many people were going to Chicago?
21.
I'm very sorry. The farmer. That is correct. He was the only one going to Chicago. Oh, right. Now then. Here we have a chance for you to get right in the money. Now, from Newell, West Virginia, Austin H. Brown wants you to give an idea to our Colgate friends just what kind of sounds the following animals make. Now, for instance, frogs croak. Can you give an imitation of a frog? Right at the microphone. All right. Now, grasshoppers chirp.
Chirp. Chirp.
All right. Now, magpies chatter.
Can't chatter.
Can't you chatter?
No.
Oh, louder than that. Louder, chatter. All right. Now, eagles scream.
Yeah!
Louder than that. Well, I'm sorry. We were trying to get you in the money here. Let me see. From Rochester, New York, Fred W. Minges wants to know, is a pikeman, a fisherman, a musician, a soldier, or a toll gate attendant?
A toll gate attendant.
I'm very sorry. He's a soldier. I'm very, very sorry. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to say goodnight and ask you to tune in next week for another Colgate Ask It Basket with new questions and new contestants and new prizes. But first, a grand letter from Miss Mary Wingarth of Denver, Colorado. She writes, Colgate Dental Cream makes my teeth so sparkling clean, I never miss a chance to smile. And after brushing my teeth, my mouth stays fresh and sweet for hours. Thanks, Mrs. Wingarth. And friends, after you try Colgate Dental Cream, I'm sure you'll continue using it for the sake of your teeth, your breath, and your smile.
And now, genial Jim McWilliams and his school bell leave us until our next Ask It Basket.
So long, children, until next week. See you then. Good night.
Daylight saving time ends Sunday, September 24th. If your community has been on standard time right along, this program will reach you 1 hour later. Otherwise, tune in next week as usual. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Keep your dials tuned to this station for Strange as It Seems, which follows immediately. WJSV, Washington.
Hi there, this is Bill Bragg, the man with a million friends, and you're listening to The Glowing Dial with my good friends Big John and Steve.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of the Ask It Basket that was What is a Ruminant from Thursday, September 21, 1939, originally over CBS. And we have two more game shows to bring you in this Playing Games with You edition of The Glowing Dial. We're going to get to all of that and more right after this. Hi, Big John here to tell you all about the Glowing Dial online store. The Glowing Dial online store is your one-stop shop for all things Glowing Dial. You're sure to be fashionable with a t-shirt or sweatshirt emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. And your favorite beverage will taste even better in an official Glowing Dial mug or stein. How about a Glowing Dial tote bag so you can carry around your OTR with style and grace? Or be the first on your block to own Volume 1 of the Glowing Dial Celebrity Interviews on audio CD. You can surf the internet with class with an official Glowing Dial mouse pad. And if that weren't enough, we'll be adding more items with new logo designs in the near future. Remember, every time you purchase an item from our online store, you're helping to support us here at the Glowing Dial. You know, you don't even have to leave your home and trudge into your overcrowded, noisy mall. You can just sit comfortably in front of your computer and do all your shopping online. All you have to do is to point your browser to glowingdial.com, click on the Glowing Dial online store link. Then, through the wonders of internet technology, you would be instantly whisked to our store's main page. There, you'll see all the items we have to offer. You're sure to find something to suit your fancy. And remember, our official Glowing Dial items make great gifts, too. And the ordering process is simple and safe using CafePress.com's secure server. Most orders are shipped within 2 business days. You can even check on the status of an existing order. So head on over to the Glowing Dial online store, the only place you can get official Glowing Dial merchandise. So what are you waiting for? And we are back, folks. It's time for our next game show. That's going to be an episode of Truth or Consequences. This is a special show. This is their 6th anniversary celebrity show. And it has host Ralph Edwards and the guest stars Eddie Cantor, Jack Benny, Eddie Rochester Anderson, Phil Harris, John Charles Thomas, Dinah Shore, George Montgomery, Rudy Valley, William Bendix, Basil Rathbone, Charlie Cantor, Ken Carpenter, Harlow Wilcox, Jimmy Wallington, Truman Bradley, Don Wilson, and Jay Stewart is announcing the sponsor is Procter & Gamble for Does. Do you remember Does? I think that was a laundry soap.
Yep.
But standing by here with some more information, yes, even more than all those guest stars. We have some more information to pass on to you, and here that is Stu Chisholm.
Yes, thank you. Well, Truth or Consequences, began its radio run on March 23rd, 1940, and ran until September 12th, 1956. The show was aired on NBC and CBS at different times throughout its run, and of course it went on to television too, as we all know. Truth or Consequences was described by Life in the mid-40s as the nearest thing to insanity in radio today. Theoretically a quiz show, it was boisterous, rowdy, and full of custard pie humor, said Time. It offers $15 for correct answers, but penalties for errors are fierce. People have been put in real doghouses mounted on mechanical horses, compelled to imitate babies and dogs, and given a consolation prize of like $5. The truth, wrote Peter Lear in the Saturday Evening Post, is impossible to attain. Everybody wanted to pay the consequences to learn what Ralph Edwards and his band of fiends had in store for them. A man might be required to make love to a skunk, a woman to wash an elephant, and ladies were made to propose marriage to their escorts. Getting down on one knee while Edwards, the studio audience, and the nation heard every word. A soldier desperately tried to converse with his best girl by phone while a model sat on his lap and cooed such endearments as, "Watch out, honey, you're ruining my hair." Some stunts were so elaborate they ran for weeks and took months to set up. When they worked to perfection, they were so sensational that they became news events covered by the daily press or recapped in both major national news magazines. Ralph Edwards had served his radio apprenticeship at KROW in Oakland, and he arrived in New York in 1935 after hitchhiking across the country with little money and no job prospects. In other words, just like every broadcaster ever. But his talent was obvious, and within 3 weeks he was on the air. His weekly paycheck was in four figures, but as he later recalled, "I don't want to be an announcer." He had heard that Ivory Soap was looking for a show. After brainstorming with his wife Barbara, he hit upon a simple idea. What about Truth or Consequences? This was an old parlor game encouraged in childhood by his mother when he and his friends were grounded on rainy days. Also known as forfeit, it worked on the principle that participants tested their knowledge and had to pay a forfeit if they failed to answer. It was an immediate hit, getting almost 20 Hooper points by January 1941. The questions, described as generically tricky, were sent in by listeners who got 10 bucks each. In case an overzealous contestant might be tempted to blurt the answer, Edward had the fastest buzzer in radio. Nicknamed Beulah, the buzzer was the contestant's cue that you did not tell the truth, so you must pay the consequences. And now the fun began. So that's the skinny on Truth. Or Consequences.
That's right, and of course it later went to TV with Bob Barker as the host. That's where I remember seeing it.
And Hugh Downs, who I always remembered in that role from the show, and when he went to news, I could just never take him seriously.
Well, you know, there's a singer named Betty Johnson, wonderful lady. We interviewed her on the show back in 1997 or 99 at a convention. And she's kind of a cross between maybe Dinah Shore, Patti Page, Doris Day, just a really sweet lady. She did a song, I think it was the early 60s, called The Little Blue Man. And it was kind of a sci-fi twinged, how the little blue man
twinged?
Loves her. Yeah, it was.
Is that a word?
That's a word, yes. And the little blue man was heard to say, I love you. And the voice of the little blue man in that song was Hugh Downs.
Really?
I'll have to play that for you sometime. It's really cute. And if you want to look for it out there, I think we actually featured it after the episode we interviewed Betty in. So look in the Glowing Dial archives for the interview with Betty Johnson, and the song The Little Blue Man is in there. And that is Hugh Downs saying, I love you, I love you.
Oh, man, I bet you Mel Blanc was honked off that he didn't get that gig.
Mel Blanc was probably busy doing numerous other things for Warner Brothers. And
that's true. He was everywhere, though.
Jack Benny and so many other shows. Yeah.
And commercials and pretty much everywhere.
Yep. All right. Well, it's time to get into that program. It's the episode of Truth or Consequences. It's a 6th anniversary celebrity show. So, Stu, reach for that McGee machine.
Wrong one. Sorry.
It's not supposed to make that sound. Yeah.
Oh, sorry, you said the McGee machine. Okay.
Yes, the McGee machine.
Sorry, I hope it didn't tickle.
As in Fibber McGee. Ah, you're doing what you're supposed to do. All right. And you're also tuning in the McGee machine.
Now you're getting there, Johnny.
All right. All right, folks, so sit back, close your eyes, and remember, this is Truth or Consequence, the 6th anniversary celebrity show from Saturday, March 23rd, 1946, originally over NBC.
Listen now to the Truth or Consequences special 6th anniversary show with celebrity contestants including Jack Benny, Eddie Cantor, Phil Harris, John Charles Thomas, Dinah Shore, George Montgomery, Rochester, Rudy Valley, William Bendix, Basil Rathbone, and many others.
D-U-Z, D-U-Z.
Put dust in your washing machine. See the clothes come out so clean. When you does your wash, you'll clean.
D-U-Z does everything.
Hello there, we've been waiting for you. It's time to play Truth or Consequences. And listen to this, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, it's Thursday night on Truth or Consequences, the 6th anniversary of America's Grand Old Parlor Game. Coming over in masquerade costume to help celebrate with the daddy of Truth or Consequences are many of his famous celebrity friends of radio. So let's greet the originator and conductor of the number one fun show, dressed in a devil's costume, the headman himself, Ralph Edwards!
thank you very much, Jay Stewart, and greetings, party players. This will be a Truth or Consequences night long to remember. Each contestant who appears at our microphone tonight will be a famous radio star, but he or she will be disguised in a masquerade outfit, which in some way typifies the celebrity's personality. As Jay said, I'm dressed in a devil's outfit, my assistants are wearing clown suits, and the orchestra with conductor Frank Duvall and organist Buddy Cole are all dressed in union suits. But let's guess who this first celebrity is coming up to the microphone. Our first famous contestant tonight is dressed exactly like a banjo, with banjo eyes, banjo head, and he's pushing a giant perambulator, a tremendous baby carriage with five baby boys in the carriage. Who's it gonna be? Guy, Eddie Cantor. Hi, Eddie.
Hello, Ralph.
Welcome to our Truth and Consequences 6th anniversary
and
party.
And congratulations to you on your 6th anniversary party. Where am I? Oh, yes.
Yeah, Studio C, NBC. Yeah.
Look what I've got. What? Five straight men. Look at them.
Yes. Eddie, this is huge. Eddie, quiet, children. Quiet. Eddie
Cantor. Quiet, Papa Spank. Ida, take the kids home.
Eddie Cantor with five baby boys. What goes?
Yeah, well, all I know is I read the book My Son, My Son 2.5 times.
Oh, you're wonderful. Okay, you're correct.
I'm training my own audience. I drop the eggs and they hatch them.
Yeah. Well, look, Eddie, how's about introducing the little darlings here? Hmm? Will you introduce them?
Oh, sure. This is little Ken Carpenter Cantor.
Sounds like a pigeon.
And this one is Harlow Wilcox Cantor. Go. And this cute little cherub is Jimmy Wallington Cantor.
Go.
And this one that's drooling is Truman Bradley Cantor.
Goo.
He talks more than the others. Huh?
Yes,
and this little chubby little rascal is Don Wilson Cantor.
Greetings, boys. Really crying, that's it.
Say thank you. Say thank you, boys.
What'd they say, Eddie?
They said, with men who know best, you can put cheese on your linoleum if you shampoo with wax, so your head will be so round, so firm, it floats. That's all the commercials, roll them on.
Yes, well, they're great boys, Eddie, but the audience saw through your disguise, so you and your five sons will have to pay the consequences.
Yeah.
Now, we want you to serenade your five little fellows with a lullaby onesie twosie.
Oh, no.
Yes, and you babies must sing back. You understand, boys? All right, are you ready?
Okay, here we go, children. Listen to Daddy now. Onesie, twosie, I'm half woozy.
Twosie, threesie, it was a deezy.
Threesie, foursie, boys galoresy.
Pop will never be the same.
Foursie, fivesie, men alivesie.
Fivesie, sixie,
we ain't from Dixie.
Sixie, sevensie, seven come elevensie.
He won us in a crap game.
These boys are my ambition. They are my whole life's work. Now I've completed my mission.
Oh, Pop, you're such a
what?
Just a gigolo.
7Z, 8Z, it must have been fate, Z.
8Z, 9Z.
What's the assembly line, Z?
9Z, 10Z, let's start again, Z.
Cut it out, are you kidding?
Move over, boys. Here comes Daddy.
Oh, Daddy.
Onesie, twosie, I love you, Z.
Happy birthday, Ralph.
Thank you, Eddie Cantor. Oh, we'll be listening to your Itana Salopatica show Wednesday night. And a million thanks to our five great announcers, Ken Carpenter, Don Wilson, Harlow Wilcox, Jimmy Wallington, Truman Bradley. Here's a lollipop for each. Don't fight over it, boys.
Now,
Now, here come four more people to our celebrity masquerade TRC party. Here's a girl in a waves outfit and a sailor with SP on his sleeve. Both are wearing eye masks. Now, where else would you find a wave but on a shore, Dinah Shore, and the shore patrol is a permanent patrol for Dinah, her husband, the movie star, and ex-Army Force airman, George Montgomery! Here they are! What did I say there, anyway? Ex-Army Air Force man.
Get that straight,
sweet couple, these kids are.
Hello, Ralph. Hello. Hi.
Fine.
Happy birthday, Ralph.
Thank you very much, Dinah and George. And now we're happy you came on over from your Thursday night Bird's Eye open house to be with us, Dinah.
Thanks for the plug.
Yeah, it's nothing. Hold on a minute now, kids. The party's really beginning to rock. Here comes another guest in masquerade. This fellow is dressed as the book Lost Weekend. Who can this be?
Okay, kids, let her rip and blow. It's Harris, the star of the Jack Benny Show. Say applause on me. Many happy returns, Ralph.
Thank you, Philip, for that. Well, welcome, Phil Harris. I want you to meet Dinah Shore and her Shore Patrol, George Montgomery.
Hello, Montgomery.
Hi, Phil. I like that costume, boy.
Yeah, Lost Weekend. What's that bulge in the back?
I'm using Ray Milan as a bookmark.
Well, here's another masquerader. Let's find out what celebrity this is. He's dressed as a college boy, Yale blue turtleneck sweater, and he's wearing a megaphone upside down on his head with holes in it for eyes, and he's throwing paper watches to the audience. Who is it? Who is it, folks? Huh? Who's it going to be? Rudy Ray! Ray! Oh, yes, Ray! That's a guy! Right. It's that Thursday night dream man, Rudy Valley.
Assault me, children, assault me.
Welcome, Rudy, my boy. But how come the throwing of those phony watches in the audience?
Are you kidding? My time is your time.
Oh, yes. And that time is all the time, Rudy. We're proud to have you at our party. You know Dinah and George?
Certainly. Hello, Bird's Eye and Wolf's Eyes.
Hello, Spaniel Eye.
And you know Phil Harris, Rudy.
Hello, Steinsong.
Hello, Pinch Bottle.
Oh, you two know each other.
Indubitably.
You're crazy. It was in Kansas City. I've never been indubitably in my life.
All right, now everyone saw through indubitably. Everyone saw through your disguises, so you must all pay the consequence. Now, we'll pretend that George Montgomery here is Mr. Average Radio Listener. Let's say, George, that's you, Georgie boy.
Yes, Ralph.
You represent all of the people who just stay home and listen. Now, with a flick of your wrist, you can tune out Dinah Shore, Rudy Valley.
No.
Yes?
No.
And Phil Harris. Yes. Oh. Yes, Average Listener, you know, Average Listener.
Indubitably.
So we're going to put you three famous people with your three famous songs in three separate booths. Dinah in booth one, Rudy in booth two.
Right.
And Phil Harris in booth three.
Now, okay.
Yeah, you'll find microphones in there, and when you get in, start singing your well-known theme songs. Dinah Shore sings Blues in the Night, Rudy Valley sings My Time is Your Time, and Phil Harris sings That's What I Like About the South. All right, go in there while I explain to Mr. Average Listener, George Montgomery. George?
Yes, Ralph.
Now, here are three dials on this instrument board. They each control a booth. See, one, two, three. George, you can tune them in and out at your will.
What dial controls Dinah's booth again?
The left one, the left one.
Left one. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Yes, okay. What do you mean, thanks? Just stay away from that too much. George, you show us now how you listeners can control the radio people with just a little finger. Start singing, kids. All right, they're at it already, so tune them in.
My mom told me when I was
recognize that voice,
day.
Eh? Yeah, boy.
Dawn of the dawning, the day of the...
I don't hear the sound.
A man's got sweet talk, and he'll give a big eye.
Basement full of those berry jams, and that's what I like about him. Black eyed peas, you can eat as much as you
please. The world
stand and drink a toast on
the night.
What I like about
the
South.
You know, it's
always down there. Can't you hear the couple of feet? Stop it right there, Calis.
What I like about the South.
Who? What's the difference? Sir, tune me in. What is it? Your time is my time.
My mama done told me.
What I like about the South.
With that valley singing, that's what I like about the South.
Echoing back the blues.
This is the finale. Get them all three on. Finale.
You got us all on. That's what I like about the South.
That's how they sound. The radio is good. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Oh, me. And There you have proof of how you listeners control the greats of radio with a flick of your wrist. Thank you, Dinah Shore, George Montgomery, Phil Harris, Rudy Valley. George, we'll be seeing you in 20th Century Fox's Three Little Girls in Blue. Thanks for joining our Truth or Consequences party tonight. Well, hey, who is this coming up to the microphone now? My gosh, it's a gigantic red box with big white letters that spell D-U-Z. Who is it, folks?
Jay Stewart!
Jay Stewart, sure.
Well, sure. How does you do, folks?
Hiya, Jay. How did you ever happen to think of dressing as a Duzz box?
Well, what else, Ralph? I'm the Duzz man on this show, right?
Yes.
And besides, Duzz is the cause of lots of celebrations every wash day. It really does everything.
That it does.
And golly, Ralph, congratulations on this wash day wonder pouring in from folks everywhere. Here's one from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Mrs. Catherine Clemmie says she's going to invite Duzz to all her birthday parties from now on because at the last one, somebody spilled a dish of gooey strawberry ice cream all over her best rug.
Rug? Ugh. What'd the lady do?
She does the rug, and it looks like new.
Nothing ever floors does.
Oh, here are special congratulations to Duzz from Reading, Massachusetts. Mrs. J.P. Cook writes, I never felt more like kissing a man other than my husband as when the grocery man brought me a box of Duzz yesterday. After all the substitutes I've had to buy, it was Duzz wonderful to see that big red box again. I wanted to celebrate.
Great.
Now you see, folks, the one and only Duzz does everything. Gets the greasiest work clothes clean without hard scrubbing. And does towels dazzling white, the whitest white any soap can turn out. And yet this wonderful new soap actually leaves the pretty colored rayons you wash brighter. Because Duzz is safer for colors than any other leading wash day package soap. Does everything.
Okie dozie, Jay Stewart. Whoa! Hold everything! Oh, what? Wait a minute. Here's a late arrival to our Truth or Consequences 6th Anniversary Celebrity Masquerade Party, and he's driving a car right on stage. And what a car! Looks like a 1919 model. Well, and in the driver's seat, a familiar-looking fellow with a big white cap, goggles, scarf, and a duster, a white coat turned up around the ears, and look, welcome.
Mr. Bentley will be along in a minute.
Well, Rochester.
It ain't Fred Allen, kiddie.
No, and it isn't Jack Benny either, Rochester. Where's your boss?
Well, Mr. Benny. Oh, he's under the hood. Somebody's got to make this automobile run.
Am I late?
Jack Benny!
If Mary saw me now, she'd punch me right in the nose.
What on earth?
Just once, I want to see these pictures in the papers. Just once.
What?
Got a good title for the show tonight, Junk or Consequence.
What on earth are you doing under
the... Oh, you really want to go into this?
Shall we do it?
We tried it once this afternoon. It was lousy.
No. What on earth are you doing under the hood, Jack?
I had to do this ever since the motor's been missing. You get used to it.
Yeah. Is it warm under there?
No, I keep my face in the fan. It's cooling.
Uh-huh. Use more toupees that way.
That's quite a costume you're wearing there, Jack. Champ written across it. Sort of a track outfit. Must be a workout, huh? When do you expect to have the motor back in the car?
Oh, when he sells the house. He's got the motor home generating electricity.
What's an old motor? I see a lot of people here, Ralph. I guess the party's underway.
Yeah, eh? Jack, come right on up here now. And since your identity was guessed, you'll have to pay the consequences.
Well, do I...
We thought a good thing for you...
Shall I get my...
Would be to stand up here in front of these people...
I brought my violin.
And you know. Play your favorite tune on your violin.
No, I'm not prepared. I couldn't.
Okay, well, then, in that case...
Here it is, boss!
Oh, yes.
Okay, fine. Just a second.
Better see if it's in tune, Jack. Wait a minute.
I look like a doll tonight.
Hold it a minute, Jack. As a further consequence, Rochester will pass up and down the aisle with a waste basket, you see? Members of the audience...
And Harris will just pass.
Yeah. Pass out. Ow. Members of the audience may contribute whatever you wish, ladies and gentlemen. Well, not that.
Then, when you have finished your number, Jack, we'll look in the basket and see what contributions you've received.
You mean I get to keep everything that's in the basket?
Yes, everything.
Oh, that's interesting. Three choruses, Rochester.
Just one.
Oh, yeah, Rochester.
Yes, boss?
Stay out of the balcony, just the reserved seats.
Okay, boss.
All right, now here we go.
Thank you. Thank you very much. With my hat on, it doesn't make any difference which side you take.
Benny! Mr. Benny!
What? Wait a minute. I got a script here. What is it, Roger? Huh?
Do you know a Mr. Elmer Fife from Indianapolis?
Elmer Fife? No, I don't, Rog.
Sorry, Mr. Fife, we can't take your $100 check.
Rochester, mind your own business. Hello, Elmer, old pal. Thank you.
Okay, come on up here, and let's see how much we got in here. Bravo, Jack Benny.
Thank you. Rochester, how did we, what interesting items were dropped in the basket?
Well, here's something.
Well, a gun. I can use that.
There's a note tied to the handle.
What does it say?
It says, now is not too late.
I got another peach of a line coming up. Wait till you hear this. Wonder what it means. I knew that would get a yell. Go ahead. You say now is not too late. Wonder what it means.
P.S. Pass the bucket again. I forgot the bullets.
Well, there are a lot of other interesting things in here, Jack. Plus $2.97, which Jack can turn over to his favorite charity. Won't you do that, Jack?
I sure will, folks. $2.97. See, I'll give it to my favorite charity in the morning. I'm sure Mary's mother will thank you very, very much. Come on, Rochester. Good night, folks.
Good night, Jack. Good night, Jack. Jack Benny, and thank you, Rochester, for joining our 6th anniversary Truth or Consequences party. We'll be listening for your regular Sunday show, Jack. Well, it looks as if we hit the jackpot again. Here come three celebrities in masquerade. The first one is dressed with the bottom part of him a kitchen stove, and on top of the stove is a house, and his head is sticking out of the chimney. It looks like Home on the Range. I wonder who it can be. Well, it must be John... Yes! America's beloved baritone, star of the Sunday Westinghouse show, John Charles Thomas!
Mr. Thomas. Happy New Year.
Welcome to our 6th anniversary party, Mr.
Thank
Thomas.
Thank you, Ralph, and congratulations. 6 times.
Oh, well, thank you, Mr. Thomas. Now, wait a minute. What's this? Here comes a familiar-looking fellow swaggering up to the microphone and wearing a Brooklyn Dodgers baseball uniform and a catcher's mask. Ho-ho, who's this? Right, the star of the Life of Riley and Teal show every Saturday night, just after Truth or Consequences, William Bendig. Hi, William.
Here's that foul ball again.
Well, take off that catcher's mask, Bill Bendix, and meet the world-famous baritone, John Charles Thomas.
Well, hiya, Johnny.
How do you do, Mr. Bendix? From that uniform you're wearing, I take it you're a loyal Brooklyn Dodger fan.
I'll say. Boy, did you ever see them Dodgers play?
Yes, but I like baseball better.
What a revolting development this is.
Now, hold on a minute, fellas, and get a load of this guy. He's dressed as Sherlock Holmes with that famous hat and curl stem pipe.
Yes.
Who is it, audience? Who is it?
Basil
Rathbone, yes. The famous Sherlock Holmes of radio and screen. Good evening, Mr. Rathbone, or should I say Sherlock Holmes?
Good evening, everybody. I must ask that none of you leave the room.
Why not?
The show's not over.
No, it isn't, gentlemen, indeed. And since your identities have been guessed, you must all pay the consequences. Now, if we can just find out one more fella, if we can just find that one, you must all sing the quartet from Rigoletto.
I sing.
Well, here's an intelligent-looking fellow dressed in a Napoleon's outfit. Long coat that scrapes the floor, big Napoleon's hat. Who do you think it is, gentlemen? Who can it be, huh?
Well, I should think
it isn't Nelson Eddy, is it?
No.
Is it
human?
No, but you're getting warm.
They're coming from left field now.
Yes.
Then it must be Finnegan of Duffy's Tavern.
Oh, you peeked under the mask.
Finnegan of Duffy's Tavern. Do you really sing opera, Finnegan?
Finally.
Yeah,
listen.
All right, gentlemen. Quiet. Yes. Here's your man, the quartet from Rigoletto. Music, maestro.
Mimi.
Me too.
We're the quartet from Rigoletto.
Yes, we are. We learned this song like they taught us. Tra-la, tra-la. Monsters think we are very clever.
But they're only saying that because it's
good. <No!
laughs> I'm Bendix of the Riley clan. Life of.
Gotta do it, too, hurry up.
I'm Holmes, the English Charlie Chan.
Pick what's in the noodle.
I'm north, I'm east, I'm westing a hound. Why won't this do? This drip. This a drop.
Shut up.
Oh, me.
Yes, you.
I won't.
You must.
I won't.
I'm tired.
I'm Finnegan.
I'm Bendix.
I do.
You do. I don't.
I does.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We're
through.
Achoo.
Thank you.
Shut up.
You put a stiletto in poor Rigoletto. You made us feel so blue.
Boo, 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 boo.
So blue.
Boo, 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 boo.
Shame on you.
Wonderful, wonderful people. Basil Rathbone, John Charles Thomas, William Bendix, who's running right now to his next show that follows, Life of Riley, and Charlie Finnegan Cantor, thank you for honoring Truth or Consequence's 6th anniversary with your visit. Well, Suds Alive, get a load of these guys. They're all dressed up in flowing white robes with crowns on their heads. My gosh, it must be our sponsors, Mr. Proctor and Mr. Gamble!
Happy anniversary from P&G. Brought to you by D-U-Z.
Well, thank ye. I see you brought along your lovely singing queen and her washing machine. So strike up those suds and sing out.
D-U-Z, D-U-Z.
Put suds in your washing machine.
D-U-Z does everything.
Work shirts come out oh so clean.
D-U-Z does everything.
And are your towels white?
White, white, white.
All your colored rayons are brighter, too.
A D-U-Z does everything.
You'll find does more for you.
D-U-Z does everything.
Ah, that was sensational.
Well, let's face it, does is a sensational soap. If you've got a mile-high stack of grimy towels, just does them and they'll dazzle. No soap does them whiter. If you've got a raft of greasy work clothes, just does them and they'll be shining clean without any hard scrubbing. If you've got a lot of lovely colored rayons in your wash, just does them and they'll sparkle. Does leaves colors brighter than any other leading wash day packing soap. So why take less than the best? Oh, I tell you, does everything.
Yeah, dear me, says that every lesson 11 does. We have about 1 minute now. You've heard from a whole lot of stars. Now we're going to just go into the front parlor here. It can't be a sixth anniversary without hearing from our real cast, the American public. Raise your hands. We'll find out where you're from. Tell us what star you'd like to talk to. Quickly, Al, get the microphone cord. Raise them up. Hello, soldier. Come here. Shout your name in here. What is your name?
California.
I see. Jack Dempsey's up. Jack Dempsey. He is. Where's Jack Dempsey? He was back there. Take a bow. And would you like to speak to Jack Benny?
Huh? Oh, I'd rather take Basil Rathbone.
Basil Rathbone. He'd rather take Basil Rathbone. All right. And let's have some more. Some more stuff. Basil Rathbone. Here's a man who wants to say hello to you. What's your name, soldier?
Great Sprout. San Diego, California.
San Diego.
Oh, very happy to meet you, soldier.
Right. Now let's have some more. Hello. What is your name?
Kay Islam.
Where are you from?
California.
What star would you like to talk to?
Jack Benny.
Jack Benny. He's there, I think. Jack, well, here's a lady from California. From whereabouts in California?
Park.
All right. What is your name?
Kay Islow.
Miss Islow, Jack Benny. She's from Huntington Park. Jack, just want to say hello to us.
How do you do? I'll be right over.
No. That's all right, Jack. You don't have to come down and kiss her. It's all right. You don't have to come down and kiss her. What is your name, please?
What? Agnes Thompson from Michigan.
Agnes Thompson from Michigan.
I'm Jack Benny from Waukegan, Illinois.
All right. Thank you very... He's a violinist, he says. Okay. You got to meet the stars, and that was... Jack is trying to sell... in there. All right, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I can't begin to thank all our famous guests for helping us celebrate. This NBC family is a real warm-hearted group. Thanks, Eddie Cantor, Don Wilson, Ken Carpenter, Harlow Wilcox, Truman Bradley, Jimmy Wallington, Phil Harris, Dinah Shore, George Montgomery, Rudy Valley, Jack Benny, Rochester, John Charles Thomas, William Bendix, Basil Rathbone, and Charlie Cantor. Ralph Edwards saying, good night, everybody!
Ralph Edwards' Truth or Consequences came to you from Hollywood's Radio City.
Don't forget, folks, the party continues here at Truth or Consequences. We'll be looking forward to your visit next week when Does will again present Truth or Consequences. A souvenir token for everybody on tonight, a gold engraved full of a wristwatch. Thanks a lot, gang. Good night.
Angel fair with golden hair.
For lovely, lustrous hair, use Dreen shampoo with hair conditioning action. Dreen reveals as much as 33% more luster than any soap. Removes the drab, dulling film left by all soap shampoos. No other shampoo, only Dreen, with hair conditioning action, leaves your hair so lustrous, yet so easy to manage.
This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company.
Good ladles, evening and gentlemen. This is J. Ronburn inviting you to hear the Gliling Dole. I mean the Dueling Glile. Well, you know. It's the best in old raid timeo with Big Ston and Jeeve. Don't Dutch that tile.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Truth or Consequences. That was a special 6th anniversary celebrity show from Saturday, March 23rd, 1946. And we have one more game show to bring you in this Playing Games with You edition of The Glowing Dial. We're going to get to that right after this. Hi, Big John here to tell you how you can help support The Glowing Dial. You know, it takes a lot of time and effort to maintain The Glowing Dial page and produce new episodes of the show. It also takes something we usually don't have enough of, money. The Glowing Dial page and show are nonprofit entities, and all costs incurred come out of our pockets, and we could use a little help from you, our listeners. There are several ways you can help support The Glowing Dial, and all of these methods can be accessed on our main page at www.glowingdial.com. One way to support us is to check on the PayPal donation box icon on our main page and make a donation. It can be as little or as much as you can afford. Every little bit helps. Another way is to purchase items from the Glowing Dial online store through CafePress.com. There you will find an ever-increasing variety of items emblazoned with the Glowing Dial logo. You can also shop in the Glowing Dial bookstore through our association with Amazon.com. Every time you order something from our bookstore, you are helping to support the Glowing Dial. If you're a fan of Dick Organ's radio work, then why not order the complete set of Chicken Man episodes on CD? Just scroll down our main page until you see those silly dancing chickens. Purchase of this set also helps to support us here at the Glowing Dial. So there you have it, folks. Four ways that you can help support us and ensure the continuation of the Glowing Dial page and show. We thank you in advance. And we are back, folks. Time for our last game show in this Playing Games With You edition of the Glowing Dial. It's going to be an episode of the really fun game show called Can You Top This? And it's called Complaints. It's from Saturday, January 11th, 1947, originally over NBC. And our host is Ward Wilson. Our panelists are Senator Ford, Harry Hirschfield, Joe Laurie Jr., and Peter Donald. Charles Stark is announcing, and the sponsor is Colgate Palmolive. Standing by across the desk is Stu to give us some more information on Can You Top This?
Yes, Can You Top This was a popular radio panel show in which the comedians told jokes and tried to top one another. The unrehearsed program, sponsored at one point by Colgate Palmolive, was created by veteran vaudevillian Senator Edward Ford. That senator in quotes, of course. And he claimed he was taking part in a joke session at a New York theatrical club when he conceived the idea. However, the format was quite similar to a prior joke-telling radio series, Stop Me If You've Heard This One, that ran from 1939 to 40. And that featured Ford and cartoonist Harry Hirschfield as panelists. Many jokes involved ethnic humor told in dialect. Listeners contributed approximately 3,000 jokes a week. Peter Donald told the best of these jokes, each one centered on a different topic, while a laugh meter took note of the audience reaction. The Knights of the Clown Table, Ford, Hirschfield, and Joe Laurie Jr., attempted to top listeners with their own jokes, which sometimes presented an extra challenge as their jokes had to be pertinent to the topic. Any submission used on the program received $10. Each time a panelist failed to top Peter Donald's joke, as registered on the laugh meter, which went as high as 1,000, an additional $5 was added, so a listener could potentially win as much as $25, though on many occasions, Donald's jokes would score perfect 1,000s, which would guarantee the top prize to the submitter regardless of how the rest of the panel fared. Further, listeners were also given phonograph recordings of Peter Donald telling their jokes on the air. The panelists claimed that together they knew over 15,000 jokes. Can You Top This? Debuted on New York's WOR radio in 1940. NBC picked up the show in 1942, and it continued 12 more years. Hosts at one time or another included Peter Donald, Ward Wilson, Roger Bauer, and Dennis James. The jokes were compiled into two book collections, Can You Top This? And Cream of the Crop, published by Grosset and Dunlap and Dell in 1947 and 1949. And I just can't help but think when I'm reading this how easy the writers had it, because the listeners created their material.
Yeah, exactly. But these guys, I mean, they just had memories like elephants, I guess, is the...
Well, it's kind of an early version of Whose Line Is It Anyway? Kind of like improv joke telling.
Exactly. But they just knew hundreds of thousands of jokes. I mean, they just can remember them right at the top of their head. I can't do that. I got like maybe a handful I can tell, and some of them I can't tell on this program.
Yeah, but have you ever been sitting around the table with the guys, right, and one person tells a joke, and that reminds you of another one, and you tell one, and then someone else tells, and then the whole idea is you're sitting there trying to hold back. You're trying to remember that joke you just remembered because you hadn't thought of it in years, and then when it's your turn, you got to cough
forget.
It up. Yeah, but y'all feed each other. I had one night turn into an eight-hour joke-telling session. We were breaking up from a party, and then somebody popped a joke, and for the next 8 hours till the sun came up, we're telling jokes. It was idiocy, really, but we were young and stupid.
All right, well, it is time not to tell a joke, but to let the cast of Can You Top This tell a few jokes to us. So, Stu, if you'll reach for the McGee machine.
Man, I do that a lot.
Yeah, you do.
Do I get paid for this?
You get paid twice what I get paid.
Oh, okay. Well, that's fair.
And there's our familiar static. All right, so folks, sit back, close your eyes, and remember, can you top this? This is Complaints from Saturday, January 11th, 1947, originally over NBC.
Once again, Palmolive Brushless and Palmolive Lather, Palmolive, the largest selling brand of shave creams in the world, present Can You Top This? Starring Senator Ford.
Good evening.
Harry Hirschfield.
Howdy.
And Joe Laurie Jr.
Hello.
And now, here's Palmolive Shave Cream's Master of Ceremonies, Ward Wilson.
Good evening, friends, and welcome to Can You Top This? Our unrehearsed corn roast. Our three wits do not know what jokes have been chosen until the people's representative, Peter Donald, tells them on the air. Our three gagsters have no scripts. They rely on memory and ability to switch jokes and make them fit the subject. If Peter Donald tells your submitted story, you get $10 plus a phonograph record personally autographed by our wits of Peter Donald telling your story on the air. The laughs are registered on the big Palmolive shave meter in full view of the studio audience. Each time our wits fail to top your score, you win an additional $5, which means you may win $25. So let's get on with the laughs. Are you ready, fellas?
Ready.
I guess so.
Little dubious again tonight, eh, Senator? However, here's the first joke of the evening. It's sent in by Mrs. Ann Cohen of St. Louis, Missouri, and it's on the subject of complaints. Hope you don't have too many. And, Pete, we certainly have none with you, so let's get going.
Well, Dr. Probe, a well-known diagnostician, was sitting around his office one afternoon. He was tying up an old sweetheart's x-ray plates with blue ribbon and passing the time, when all of a sudden the door opened and a little fellow walked in.
He said, "Oh, excuse me, please, but are you Dr. Probe, why couldn't you be a dentist?"
The fellow says, "Don't get excited, sir. Come in. Sit down. What's your complaint?"
"Oh," he says, "Doc, have I got trouble? Oh, what schmerzen I got. Oh." He says, "The foot hurt me down here in the metatarsal arch, and I said, I got neuritis and arthritis and phlebitis and gastritis and can't sleep at nightis. I got everything. Oh, it's awful. And also, I got such chills and trembles that I can hear my liver shiver."
Doctor says, "Well, you have this all the time?"
He says, no. The only time I feel better is when I drink a cup of tea. But the relief is only temporary, comes back."
So the doctor says, "Well, I think I know what's wrong with you, sir." He says, "You're run down. I'll give you some medicine to take, and I'll also give you a list of foods you should not eat. Cut out all starches, such as bread, potatoes, puddings. And above all, you can have your tea, but don't put sugar in it. Now, you remember, don't put sugar in your tea." Well, the fellow went away. 3 weeks later, he came back. Doctor says, "Well, sir, how do you feel now? You follow my instructions?"
He says, "I feel wonderful. I feel scrumptious. I took the pills. I don't have any pains. Of course, I still feel better when I have my tea."
The doctor said, "Well, that's all right. But did you remember not to take sugar in the tea?"
He says, "Well, certainly. Never again do I put sugar in the tea. I put the sugar on my tongue and then I drink the tea."
Well, on the word of the Palmolive shave meter, Peter, that got 1,000, which automatically gives Mrs. Cohen $25 and sends our three wits out in the quest of nothing but laughs. And the first hand I see facing me, and it's a clean one, too, belongs to Harry Hirschfield.
Well, Pete, I wish I could tell it with a dialect that Pete tells it with. He's the master. But he did remind me of this, just as crazy a story. A fella doesn't feel well, so they says, "Get Professor Schnutz, von Schnutz. He's a great professor, and he'll give you a diagnosis that'll be wonderful." So he gets Professor Schnutz, comes there, and this Professor Schnutz puts him on a table and begins to puts his hands on the guy's neck and squeezes it, feels his arms and his legs and his back. He puts his hands in there, and then he stops. And the fellow says, "Tell me the truth, doctor. I can take it. Let me have it. What is it?" He says, "We're going to have rain." He says, "What do you mean we're going to have rain?" He says, "I can feel it in your bones."
Well, I can see it in the palm olive shave meter. 1,000 that time, Harry, tying Mrs. Cohen's 1,000, but not topping it. Her 25 is still very safely in tow, and Senator Ford, I think your hand was upraised second.
Yeah, I think this would come under the heading of complaints. Little Oscar Potts and Goggles' father said to him, said, Oscar, every time you're a bad boy, it gives me another gray hair. And Oscar said, gee, Pop, you must have been an awful stinker. Grandpa's bald.
Short but very successful, Senator. The palm olive shave meter gave that 1,000 also. So up till now, we have a perfect round going, and the only person able to
spoil it,
if at all, is Joe Laurie, Jr.
Well, that complaint gag, I go back to Harry Breen, a very, very funny comedian many years ago. He told this one about a kid going into McPherson's bakery. And McPherson says, what do you want? He says, I got a complaint my mother sent me. He says, what is the complaint? He says, my mother found a fly in the raisin cake. What are you going to do about it? He says, go home and tell your mother to bring the fly back and I'll give her a raisin for it.
I don't know how far back that Breen goes. If it's Breen, Labard, and Barry, it's plenty far, Joe, but the joke is still solid, apparently. The palm olive shave meter giving it 1,000, giving us a perfect round all the way.
As a matter of fact, I think Harry Breen was one of the first of our nut comedians years ago.
Yes,
and he
was
great.
An extemporaneous singer, too.
A fly comedian, apparently. Songs, dances, and funny things. Well, the answer is that we send Mrs. Cohen $25 with the compliments of palm olive shave creams, plus a 1,000 club certificate, and in addition, we're sending Mrs. Cohen an actual phonograph record of Peter Donald telling her story on the air. And now, here's Charles Stark with the biggest shaving news in history.
3 men out of every 4 get more comfortable, actually smoother shaves the Palmolive brushless way.
Yes, 3 men out of every 4 get more comfortable, actually smoother shaves the Palmolive brushless way.
This is not just a promise, not just a claim. Palmolive brushless offers you proof, definite proof that 3 men out of every 4 tested got more comfortable, actually smoother shaves the Palmolive brushless way.
1,297 men tried the new different Palmolive brushless way to shave, and no matter how they shaved before, 79% found beards easier to cut, 75% got less razor pull, 69% closer shaves, 82% smoother feeling skin.
And 3 men out of every 4 got more comfortable, actually smoother shaves the Palmolive brushless way.
So get Palmolive brushless and try the new Palmolive brushless way to shave. Here's all you do. Wash your face with soap and water. Rinse. Soap your face thoroughly again and apply Palmolive brushless. Smooth it upward into your beard. This way you get the full benefit of Palmolive brushless beard conditioning effect. Then shave.
And that's all. But remember, it's not just a promise, not just a claim. Palmolive Brushless offers you proof, definite proof that 3 men out of every 4 get more comfortable, actually smoother shaves the Palmolive Brushless way.
I must remember that upward into the beard. But now back to the business of jokes once again, and here's one sent in by, Pierre Pagel of Nazomene. I believe that's correct. Nazomene, Wisconsin. And the subject of this joke is something I hope you never have with your wives, although I'm a little dubious. Argument. Argument is the subject under discussion. And once again, we have... we have no argument with the way Pete will tell it, so let her ride, Pete.
This is about a little milquetoast that he brought his wife a dog as a present. It was supposed to be a very, very bright, intelligent dog. But after 5 hours of yelling at this thing, all it did was just sit there. Couldn't even get it to stand up. It just sat there like... last week's custard, you know. So she was furious. She said, John, did you say that this animal was intelligent?
He says, it should be, honey. It comes from a family of very well-educated dogs. Its father was a West Pointer, and the mother was a Phi Beta Cocker.
She said, well, it's perfectly stupid. It won't do anything. Take it back to the store.
He said, no, honey, give it a chance. Don't rush the dog.
She says, don't rush it. In 5 hours, it hasn't even moved when I called it.
He says, listen, honey, you know, you got to be patient with dogs. You remember at first you had trouble getting me to obey you.
Well, they got rid of the dog.
Well, Pete...
Uh...
Pete, we're ready to listen anytime you get to the joke. Up till now, the Palmolive shave meter says zero. But nothing. So our three wits should have a fairly easy time getting over this one. The best news I can pass along is that Mr. Pagel now has $10, and it looks like he'll be stuck with it as far as...
We don't know if we're even going to obey you after that.
And I don't blame any of the three of you. Who wants to be the first one to try and top that?
I thought of a joke on obedience. I'm afraid to tell it now.
Well, then, this tee off with Harry Hirschfeld once again.
Talking of argument, two fellas are standing in front of their respective stores. And a very homely guy went by. Oh, a brutally homely guy. And one fellow said to the other guy, "You see that terrible-looking object, that terrible homely guy that just went by?" He said, "Yeah." He says, "He's a member of the Ku Klux Klan." The guy said, "That homely guy, that terrible-looking thing has been going by here for 30 years. He ain't a member of the Ku Klux Klan." The guy says, "I'm telling you, that awful-looking object, that terrible-looking thing, is a member of the Ku Klux Klan." The other fellow says, "He ain't. But a hood over his head wouldn't do him no harm."
Well, that didn't do you any particular harm, Harry. The Palmolive Shave Meter gave that one 1,000 that time, which slightly tops Mr. Pagel's zero, or shouldn't I mention that? And I'll look for the next hand that belongs to Joe Lurie Jr.
Well, I got a short one. This doesn't count. About a fella telling a friend of his, he says, "Me and my wife's mother, my mother-in-law, are always arguing. You know what? He says, I call her Moth for short, because she's always chewing the rag." That didn't count.
You said it wouldn't count.
That almost was as obedient.
It didn't.
The one I want to tell on this is about a bus. A bus was crowded with people, and there's a man and an elderly lady standing there, and they're looking for a seat. They're just watching somebody get up, and they're looking for that seat. So somebody gets up, and they both rush for the seat, and the young fella gets it quick, and he sits down. The woman gives him a terrible argument, gives him dirty looks and argues with him. Finally, she ends up, she says, "Young man, aren't you ashamed of yourself? Tell me the truth. Doesn't your conscience hurt you?" He says, "Yeah, but not as bad as my feet."
Well, it's a good thing Mr. Pagel didn't get anything, Joe. That got a little better. 700, as a matter of fact, on the palm olive shaving.
Got
which
two
is
more notes.
Considerable increase.
I got a 7 and a 0.
So Mr. Pagel is still clinging tenaciously to that original $10. And, Senator, we haven't heard your contribution
well,
yet.
I just want to toss this one in. I think it comes under that subject, too. Mrs. Ruth Pratt, the former congresswoman of New York here, she rented her house to one of the Russian representatives over here, one of the Russian delegates. And now she's been arguing with him for a long time, trying to get him out of the house. It's the only place the Russians haven't walked out of.
You said that didn't count. It counted for 800.
Actually, it wasn't an argument. They weren't arguing. Just trying to get rid of him. Well, anyway, Mr. and Mrs. Feamsby had been married for 10 years, and they'd been having their daily battle. And she started to snivel, and she says, "I can remember when you asked me to say the one word that would make you happy." And he said, "Yes, and you said the wrong word."
Should have told those backwards, Senator. The first one got 800, and the second one 650 on the palm olive shave meter that time.
I'm not good at arithmetic. What does that add up to?
Let's see, 1,450.
That's good. That's over the meter.
That's better than we have. But... the tidings are that we send Mr. Pagel $10 with the compliments of Palmolive shave creams to make him feel a little bit better, a copy of the brand new Can You Top This joke book written by our three wits and now on sale wherever books are sold. And in addition, we're sending Mr. Pagel an actual phonograph record of Peter Donald telling his story on the air.
Ward, you send him the record. I'll give him the needles. Don't worry.
You better leave town when he gets it, too.
He won't need a needle.
Surface right. Right you are. Well, here we go to a brand new start. Now, let's see what's going to happen. Here's a joke sent in by Orvido M. Hill of Marquette, Michigan. And the subject of this round is instructions. Instructions, of which we will give you none, Peter. So take it from there.
Thank you. Well, a woman was giving her new maid some instructions. She says, "Now it's agreed your salary is satisfactory." She said, "The hours suit you. You have Thursday afternoon, all day Sunday off. Is that all right with you?" The maid says,
Oh, yes, ma'am. That is just Jim Dandy. That's fine.
She says, well, you know what you will do. You'll clean and polish the crockery and the cutlery.
Oh, she says, you said it, and I'll wipe the plates and knives, too, yes.
She says, well, one more thing before you start work. She said, we run this house on a schedule that I'm sure will fit in with you. It'll be very easy. However, sometimes my husband brings home some unexpected guests, maybe 10 or 12 people, brings them home unexpectedly, and they'll want cocktails and dinner. Now, do you think you can be prepared for such an emergency?
The girl says, oh, don't worry. I certainly will be prepared for an emergency like that. I'll just keep my trunk packed.
Well, Pete, apparently, I have to read it as I see it. Apparently, someone out there was sitting on a feather because the actual laugh got 800 and somebody kicked it over to 1,000, which I must accept. So, Mr. Hill has that $1,000 and automatically $25, putting our wits out strictly for glory and solid laughs, we trust. And the first hand upraised belongs to Little Joe.
Well, a little Russian refugee got a job as a janitor of a tenement house. So, one day he meets one of the tenants, Mrs. Smith. And he says, Mrs. Smith, I'd like to ask you a question. You've been around a long time. He says, you know the etiquette and everything. He says, I'm going out with my girl to a ball. Do you think I should give her a corsage? She says, a what? He says, a corsage, you know, to wear flowers. She says, why, Dimitri, it isn't corsage. It's corsage. It's corsage. The same as barrage. The same as garage. It's corsage. He says, oh, corsage. Oh, thank you very much. And he leaves. The next morning, he whistles up at the dumbwaiter and says, Mrs. Smith, please send down your garbage.
Well, nothing went to waste there, Joe. That was $1,000 on the palm olive shave meter. Tying Mr. Hill's $1,000, but not topping it. He still has $25, and the next hand, I think, belongs to the senator.
Well, this is a little story that I like. I don't care whether it fits in here or not. I'm going to tell it anyway.
Can't go wrong.
And don't count it, Ward.
Okay.
A very nice little old lady, very sweet little old lady who was slightly deaf, moved in the close proximity to one of our naval ports. And soon after she took up living there, one of our battleships fired a 10-gun salute. So the little old lady who lived all by herself got up out of a chair, patted her dress and her hair, and said sweetly, come in. I like that. I like those things. Well, well, anyway, you know, instructions, of course, that could be a school story. My father used to tell one about up in my hometown there many, many years ago, the schoolmaster was standing in front of the fireplace with his back to the fireplace on a very cold morning, and before he started the lessons, he thought he'd give the pupils a bit of advice. He said, now remember, children, if you have anything to say, if it's important, count 50 before you say it. If it's very important, count 100. And he could see the mouths of the children counting to themselves, and all of a sudden they burst out in unison, 99, 100, your coattails are on fire.
You sort of caught on fire with that, thanks to your father, Senator. Got 1,000 on the palm olive shaving.
You can imagine how old that gag is.
Well, I'm noncommittal on that subject. I know which side my bread is buttered on, after all.
With this program, the side your face is lathered on is better.
Oh, that's very good. It was a show on that name. I'd lather be right than be president, wasn't there? Something like that? Let's see, we haven't heard from Harry Hirschfield in this round yet. No. Now, Harry.
Well, Joe, telling about Dimitri, this is a kind of a goofy story. Late at night in Moscow, with a terrible blizzard on. Oh, you know, a typical Russian blizzard. Ivan Papnikov calls up Boris Godunov. And he says, Boris, would you like to make the people happy? He says, certainly, but at 2 o'clock in the morning. Well, what do you want? He says, come right over because I've solved the situation that will stop unhappiness in the world. Run away, come over. So this guy trudges through the snow, and he comes there half dead. And he said, what's the matter? What do you want me for? He said, listen, this has been keeping me up. The world has got to be made happy. He said, the trouble with the world is it's economic. That's the whole trouble. If we can solve the economic situation, we make the world happy. And here's how we can solve it. If we can get the sons and daughters of the poor to marry the sons and daughters of the rich, we solve the whole problem. So the fellow says, where do I come in? He says, plenty. I know I'll have no trouble to get the poor to agree. It's up to you to get the rich.
Well, you can get rich on that, Harry. That was 1,000 on the palm olive shave meter. Once again, tying Mr. Hill's 1,000, but not topping it. Perfect round for the second time tonight, too. 1,000 all the way. So the glad tidings are that we send Mr. Hill $25 with the compliments of palm olive shave creams, plus a 1,000 club certificate. And in addition, we're sending Mr. Hill an actual phonograph record of Peter Donald telling his story on the air. Now here's proof of new shaving comfort.
Not just a promise, not just a claim. Palmolive Brushless offers you proof, definite proof that 3 men out of every 4 tested got more comfortable, actually smoother shaves the Palmolive Brushless way.
Yes, 1,297 men tried the new different Palmolive Brushless way to shave. And no matter how they shaved before, 3 men out of every 4 reported beards easier to cut, smoother feeling skin, less razor pull, and more comfortable, actually smoother shave.
So you be the judge. Get Palmolive Brushless and try the new, different Palmolive Brushless way to shave yourself.
Remember, it's not just a promise, not just a claim. Palmolive Brushless offers you proof, definite proof, that 3 men out of every 4 get more comfortable, actually smoother shaves the Palmolive Brushless way.
They both said it. Well, here we go back to jokes once again, and here's one that was sent in from Nora Hendrickson of San Diego, California, and it's on the subject of something I hope hasn't passed you three gentlemen, romance.
Romance. Yes, it hasn't caught up with
I notice Harry's adjusting his tie already, so it does something for him.
Pass him around, Harry.
So, Pete, let's make love to the story. It's up to you.
Well, it seems that Mrs. Fafufnik was walking down the street. She saw her friend and neighbor, Tinkerbell Birnbaum. So she said, ooh, Tinkerbell, ooh. She said, Tinker, darling, wait off a minute. I want to make with you a little chitter-chat. Says, tell me, so what's new? So Tinkerbell says, what's new? Oh, am I happy? Am I hysterical with joy and gaiety? My son just graduated from medical school. He's going to be a dentist, a DDS. That's drilling done snappily. She said, a dentist? Your son is going to be a dentist? I thought he was going to be an ear surgeon. She says, yeah, but he wanted further opportunities. After all, people only got 2 ears, they got 32 teeth, you know. She says, tell me, she says, Daphne, what's new with you? She said, am I happy? Am I happy? Saturday is getting married. My daughter, Honeysuckle. Going to have a big wedding with 10 bridesmaids, and I am going to be the macaroon of honor. Ooh, what a boy she's got when he looks at her and she looks at him. The eyeballs come out and play Boomsie Daisy. She says, that's wonderful. What is he? He's a nice fella. Is he kind to her? She says, oh, he treats her beautiful. Treats her gorgeous. And also, I know positively, he's very kind to dumb animals. She says, how do you know he's kind to dumb animals? Said, because just last night I heard him telling her that he put his shirt on a horse that was scratched.
Having done the same thing, I can appreciate that, Pete. And so did the palm olive shave meter that time to the extent of 1,000 for Miss Hendrickson, giving her automatically $25 with our compliments and putting our 3 wits out just for the glory of telling the jokes. And
Harry, you seem to be trying very hard to get in there first.
Here's a blighted case on the subject. I think this is a newie on a subject that's going around. There's a... In an office building, there's a great excitement. They hear crashing and moaning and yelling. So they rush up there to the floor, and the noise and excitement and the trouble is coming from an office that has on it Kilroy Company. So they rush in, and there is the blonde stenographer with her teeth knocked out, her eyes black, and she's laying over the typewriter. The place is in a shambles. She's moaning. And on the desk is the boss, and his eye is smashed, and his teeth are out. And on the wall, it's scribbled, Mrs. Kilroy was here.
Well, I guess that's one form of romance anyway, Harry.
Oh, sure.
At least it was 1,000 on the Palmolive shave meter, I'll tell you that, and ties Miss Hendrickson's 1,000, but doesn't top her, needless to say. And, Joe, I think your hand was raised second.
Yeah, a little Italian fellow lost his push cart. Somebody stole it on him. And he looked all over for it, looked all over. I couldn't find it at all, and he was so tired, so he went in the park and sat down on a bench. Right on the same bench next to him, there was a young couple romancing. And he was looking at the girl and holding her hands and looking at her. He says, oh, darling, I love you. I'm crazy about you. You're driving me nuts, honey. He says, I'm crazy about you. He says, your cheeks are like roses, just like roses, and your lips are like cherries. And when I look into your eyes... When I look into your eyes, I see the whole world. A little Italian fellow turns to me and says, hey, take another look, see if you can find my push card.
Well, I don't know, Joe. It sounded like you were drifting back in memory to past performances that time. But it got 1,000 on the Palmolive shave meter, once again tying Miss Hendrickson's 1,000, but not copying it. We have a perfect round going thus far, and, Senator, you are next.
Yeah, and will I fix that? Well, up in my hometown, there are two gals. One is named Phoebe Wunkle, and the other one is Nellie Fussfutter. And they get together once in a while. And Phoebe said to Nellie... She said, Nellie, you know, I'm very nonplussed. In fact, I don't know which way to turn. I'm so nonplussed, I'm really decomposed. I don't know which way to turn. So Nellie says, what do you mean you don't know which way to turn? She says, well, you see, I got a date with my boyfriend tonight, and I got two kinds of perfume. And I put Kiss Me in back of one ear and Scram in back of the other, and I forgot which is which. So Nellie said... I was upset myself last night. I was terribly upset. My boyfriend kissed me. And Phoebe said, you mean to tell me that upset you? You've been kissed before. Nellie said, yeah, but never in a canoe. You know, Nellie is really...
Senator, before
Nellie
we get
is,
to well, Nellie's
just
cousin...
Just a minute, I'm not through yet.
Oh,
this
you
is...
aren't? I was wondering.
Nellie, no, don't interrupt me. I can go on like this for all evening. Well, anyway, Nellie, she really knows a lot about football. Every time she meets a football player, he starts making passes.
I better run a little interference here, I think, Senator. According to the Palmolive Shave Meter, that was $5.50, so the facts are that we send Miss Hendrickson $25 with the compliments of Palmolive Shave Creams plus a 1,000 club certificate, and also, in addition, we're sending Mr. Hendrickson an actual phonograph record of Peter Donald telling his story on the air. And at this point, Dan Donaldson has good shaving news for brush and lather fans.
Men, if you use a brush when you shave and like oceans of rich, thick, moisture-soaked lather, try the new different Palmolive lather way to shave.
1,251 men prove the new Palmolive lather way brings smoother, more comfortable shaves to 3 men out of every 4. So get Palmolive lather and see how the new Palmolive lather way makes beards easier to cut, gives less razor pull, closer shaves, smoother feeling skin.
Here's all you do. Wash your face with soap and water. Rinse. Soap your face thoroughly again. Do not rinse. Brush Palmolive lather upward into beard to get the full benefit of Palmolive lather's beard conditioning effect. Then shave.
And that's all. But remember, the new different Palmolive lather way to shave has been proved. Proved to give smoother, more comfortable shaves to 3 men out of every 4 tested.
Top this again next week, same time, same gang. Other jokes, some new, some old. Until then, we remain yours for bigger and better.
Hello there.
This is CBS Radio Mystery Theater's Gordon Gould. You are listening to The Glowing Dial with your hosts, Big John and Steve.
And we are back, folks. Hope you enjoyed that episode of Can You Top This? That was Complaints from Saturday, January 11th, 1947, originally over NBC. And you know what? I think it's about time to say goodbye, but before we do...
Now it's time.
As our music, we have some reminders to pass along, folks. That Chicken Man set, you know you want one, you know you gotta have one. Look for those silly dancing chickens on our homepage, and that's where you go for that. The Glowing Dial online store, plenty of great gifts with a Glowing Dial logo emblazoned upon them, and we're looking into having some more Glowing Dial logos designed. Yes, custom designed.
Ooh.
Yes, don't forget. Fireworks or radio show? don't forget the Glowing Dial bookstore with our association through Amazon.com. Anything you purchase through that association helps us out here at the Glowing Dial. Don't forget to join our blog, our discussion list, and our Facebook page and get all the latest Glowing Dial news. Celebrity birthdays, there's many more than we have time to do on this program. And you can see those over at our buddy Ron Sales' page, and his link is over there on our links page. Jerry Hanniga's Audio Restoration Services, if I could say that right. It's a great way to clean up those old recordings and transcription discs.
Maybe he can restore that thing that you just bottled in.
Yeah, Jerry Hanniga's also has his old-time radio network where you can hear the Glowing Dial and many other old-time radio shows and streaming audio. And, of course, the Glowing Dial page, which has always been the internet home of the Glowing Dial. We have links for all the things we just mentioned and much, much more. And also, a great big thank you goes out to Jerry Hanniga's for his programming assistance in this and many episodes of The Glowing Dial. So, that's about it. Stu, do you have anything else to say?
No, thanks for having me sit shotgun this trip, Johnny. It was fun.
I really enjoy having you here, and we're going to get Greg in here probably in a few episodes down the road and have him fill in a little bit. He really enjoys doing that. We might even have Greg join us via Skype.
Ooh.
So, yeah, the Glowing Dial would be going technological there.
I can do that, too.
Our congratulations, of course, go out to all the astronauts who made the moon landings and all the trips into space possible. Thank you, guys. And also, happy birthday once again to Stu Chisholm.
Ah, thank you, thank you.
39 years young, or do you want to stay 21?
Well, I was born in the best year for Chevys, a good year for NASA, and a good year for disc jockeys, 1957.
All right, myself, 1962, but my birthday's not till March 14th, and we got a big thing planned for that, too. So until we see you again, actually, you hear us again. This is radio, you don't see us, and unless you look at the webpage.
That's a good thing.
And we just ran out of music, so.
Oops.
All right, folks. Until we see you again, this is Big John and Stu saying keep a positive thought. Keep looking up. Think big, and we'll see you on the radio. Goodbye.